Good evening. I'd like to call to order a regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, September 24th, 2012. We will start with the opening ceremony, which consists of our national anthem, followed by a pledge of allegiance, followed by a moment of silence for those service members that have lost their lives while defending our country. Would everybody please stand?
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming?
Thank you. Please be seated. Ms. Bettis, will you take the roll, please?
Good evening, Your Honor. Mayor Walker?
Here.
Councilmember Squires?
Here.
Councilmember Cordy?
Here.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Here.
Councilmember Lynch?
Here.
Councilmember Fetter?
Here.
Councilmember Dodge?
Here.
Okay, I'd like to make a few comments before we get started. As you see, we have a full house tonight. Let's have a respectful and orderly meeting tonight. I know there's a lot of passion in the room. We ask that you only speak when you're called to the podium, and let's respect each other. With that, we'll move on to the item four, approval of the agenda.
So move. Support.
Moved by Councilmember Lynch, supported by Councilmember Dodge. Discussion from council, from the general public. Ms. Bettis?
Councilmember Lynch?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge?
Aye.
Councilmember Fetter?
Aye.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Aye.
Mayor Walker?
Aye. Community events, we have three tonight. I'll call up Mike Jones first.
I'm here to present a couple of things on behalf of the Family Resource Center and the Commission on Aging. The first one deals with a meeting that will take place on Monday, November 5th from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock at the Maplewood Senior Center on dealing with Medicare open enrollment. People are asked to bring their Medicare cards and all their prescriptions. Counselors will be available to answer all your Medicare questions, enroll you in Part D or Medicare Advantage plans, and apply for Medicare Savings and Extra Help program for Medicare Part D. Second one refers to a series of meetings. Let me give you just a little introduction. It says, what would your life be like if you had no debt? If you're ready to improve your financial situation, this class is for you. Financial Peace is a valuable program that has helped thousands of families learn sound principles for money management, discover how to change their personal economy, budget, dump debt, and build wealth. I can speak from personal experience. This Dave Ramsey's Financial Peace University class is well worth attending. I know it helped me in several ways, better organize my finances and goals in regards to that. This class is going to take place on Wednesday evenings from September 26th to December 19th, from 6:30 to 8:30. The regular price for attending this is $100. However, community members can get a discount of $50. Seniors age 20 or 55 and up can get a senior discount of $25, and Family Resource Center parents can get a discount of only $10 for this program. If you've ever thought about, gee, it would be nice to have a little bit of money left at the end of the month instead of deciding what bills are going to be paid, this is a program that I would highly recommend and hope you will consider taking part in. You can contact Jennifer Drake at 734-793-1875 or me, email her at Jennifred, J-E-N-N-I-F-E-R-D, at GardenCityMichigan.org.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Mr. Cable?
Thank you, Your Honor and Council. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Garden City Lions Club. And again, this year, we're going to be sponsoring an annual Garden City Fire Department open house. The Lions Club does it in conjunction with the fire department every year. It's a great turnout for kids. Your parents out there that want to bring the youngsters up and climb in the fire trucks and get their pictures taken, if you want to do that, please. The firemen are real helpful, helping them do that. And if you have any questions, please call the fire department at 734-793-1780 for more information. And this event teaches kids about fire safety. The fire department members will again have their vehicle extradition demonstration. The demonstrations let citizens see firsthand how the firefighters use various tools, including the jaws of life, to remove trapped occupants in car crashes. Many other community groups and businesses will again be supporting the open house. Refreshments will be provided by the Garden City Lions Club. In this event, we're also coordinating with the Garden City DDA 5th Annual Chili Cook-Off and Car Show. A street closure from Central Avenue from the Chili Cook-Off to the fire department is also in the works. Last year's tractor rides were a huge success. There's also planned vendors alley that will include businesses and community group involvement. Please contact the DDA for more information on the cook-off at 734-261-2830. Again, 734-261-2830. And the information is also available on the Garden City website, Garden City TV. And they are looking for more chili competitors. There's going to be a huge chili cook-off there, and they need some more chili cook-off. So any group or organization that wants to compete in that, there's a lot of good payoffs for it. So please contact the downtown DDA. And like I say, they're looking for more chili cook-off contestants. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
Yes,
Cable.
Ma'am.
You never gave us a date.
The 13th.
Thank you.
13th of October?
Yes. And we're delaying it 1 hour. Usually we go 10 to 2. This year, in conjunction with the DDA's chili cook-off, we're backing it up an hour. So it's going to be 11 to 3.
Okay.
11 to 3 on the 13th of October.
Thank you, Mr. Cable.
Thank you.
Stacy Tobar from the DDA.
Good evening, Council and community. Just a few quick announcements. As prefaced, we do have our fifth annual chili cook-off on the 13th. As highlighted, we're partnering again with the fire department, catering to their open house by providing a tractor-pulled wagon from our chili cook-off area, which is in the farm market. The chili cook-off event itself is from 11 to 6 to the public. However, if you would like to submit your super fantastic chili recipe, we are taking entries for those. So far we have 5, so we're always looking for them to come up, and we do need to give the fire department's organization some competition, because I understand they just submitted as well. With that event, we have entertainment, we have live music, we have a beer tent, we have a petting zoo and putt-putt for the kids, some acrobatics. We've added a new merchant alley this year, and essentially those are just local merchants or vendors setting up tents to display their goods. And these can be people that do craft at home as well. It's a free, however, they have to raffle all products, and their portion of their raffle will go to the local charities as well, which is the primary draw and reason for this event annually. All of our details are again online at downtowngardencity.com. And you can also phone us at 734-261-2830. And I say us because it's myself and Kim, as well as our promotions committee group, which is growing, which is great. And we're meeting at 8:30 next Monday morning, so if you want to come. Also, another quick announcement. I know there's been some construction going on in the Central Business District of some sidewalk work that's near completion. We kind of slowed down a little bit so that we could maintain sidewalk access. According to working with MDOT, those bricks that we have harvested are for sale. So if you are interested, we've had a couple people purchase in mass. They're 25 cents a piece, and there's about 600 on a flat, but you don't have to buy a whole flat. But one flat, 600 bricks, approximately 11 by 12 feet. So if you could do a nice patio for $150. So with that, we hope that you come and join us on the chili cook-off. And if you have any questions or need a sign up, please do so. And also, if you are a merchant and would like to be a sponsor, we have a list of things from being a fiery hot sponsor in general to sponsoring the face painter or petting zoo. So check out our website for that information. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Torr. Okay, that's all of our community announcements. Do we have any state or county officials here tonight? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on. We have no petitions or communications. At this time, I will open up the public hearing at 7:13 p.m. for the resolution for the removal of the city manager. We will start by allowing Mr. McCleary to make his presentation or opening statements, and then I'll open it up to the public. When I open it up to the public, there's a 3-minute time limit. You can come up and make comments or statements. You cannot engage in conversation with council members or with Mr. McCleary. No questions or answer period. It's your opportunity to make a comment or a statement. So with that, Mr. McCleary.
Honorable Mayor Walker and City Council, first of all, thank you for the opportunity to address you tonight before you make a final decision on whether to remove me as your city manager for the city of Garden City. I would like to start out by just saying how much I appreciate all of the kind comments, encouragement, and words of support I've received over the past several weeks from so many people. Words cannot even begin to express how much it means to me and my family that so many people have confidence in me and the work that I have done for the city. Your Honor, we have been through a lot during these past 2 years. We were facing a financial catastrophe of unprecedented proportions. When I joined the city's management team in 2010, the city had a budget that was operating at almost a $1 million deficit. The community's taxable value was plummeting, and we were facing a $4 million gap between expenditures and revenues. Garden City was one of the top 5 communities in Wayne County in terms of housing foreclosures and resulting vacant and blighted properties. There was no comprehensive street improvement program, no comprehensive sidewalk improvement program, and no real plans for addressing other capital needs of the city to make sure that we continue to invest in the vital infrastructure of the city. To address these daunting challenges, I have had to make many difficult and sometimes unpopular recommendations to council to turn the city around and set it on a path of financial sustainability for the long term. I had to recommend an 8-mil tax levy to try to close the budget gap. When we ended up with a 12-mil tax proposal that failed, I had to recommend laying off 11 employees and eliminating 19 full-time positions, restructuring departments, creating special assessments for street lighting, and establishing fees for rubbish collection services just to balance a general fund budget that was shrinking from $19 million to $15 million. And through the hard work and cooperation of a dedicated city staff, excellent recommendations from city employees and citizens, and a willingness and support from city council members, we were able to turn the city's finances around. The city continues to provide all of the core municipal services it did before, but with a 20% smaller budget than just 2 years ago, and with 43% less staffing than 10 years ago. We restructured the street improvement design and special assessment process to increase the participation of property owners in the design process. We created a multi-year capital improvement plan, the first of its kind for the city. We have restructured code enforcement functions to streamline and speed up cooperative efforts with property owners for voluntary compliance, or, unfortunately, when necessary, enforcement action. We utilized available web technology to improve communication between City Hall and our citizens with applications such as C-ClickFix, Nixle, Facebook, Twitter, QR codes, and even a smartphone app. Within the past year, our citizens have put their faith in us by approving a library millage and a police and fire millage so that we can continue providing vital services. A great deal has been accomplished within a relatively short period of time, but challenges still lay ahead. We need to continue to closely monitor the trends with taxable value, revenue sharing, and other components that drive the financial health of the city, and be willing and able to make adjustments to live within our means. We must continue our work to formulate comprehensive street and sidewalk and other capital programs and determine how we will fund these vital improvements so that our community remains an attractive, vibrant, and vital place to live, work, and recreate. We need to continue restructuring city operations and invest in new technologies to maximize efficiency and productivity while providing those services that are at the core of our existence as a municipal government. We need to continue our discussions with surrounding communities on feasible and cost-effective alternatives for municipal service delivery through collaboration or consolidation. We need to engage in comprehensive strategic planning to determine the future of the community, where we are going, and how we are going to get there. And we can only do all of this by informing, involving, and engaging our citizens in the decision-making process. Now, I know that it's been difficult adapting to a professional city manager after years of promoting police chiefs to the position. I am sensitive to that change, and I understand that it is difficult. I pride myself on my honesty and integrity. I tell it like it is, as you know. Not like I think you want to hear it. You always know where I stand on issues. What you see is what you get with me. I work hard to try to analyze situations and to give you the best information I have available based on my professional experience so that council can make informed decisions. I don't sugarcoat facts. Maybe this is uncomfortable for some people, but when you are straightforward, direct, and honest in all that you do, then you are consistent in your actions and in your message. And that way you build public trust. And when you are a public servant, honoring the public's trust should be your number one priority always. Honorable Mayor and Council, we have a lot of work left ahead of us. We cannot allow personal differences to derail us from accomplishing the public's work. And if we do have differences between council and administration on where we're going, how we're getting there, I would hope that I would get clear and concise direction from the city council on what your expectations are. We cannot continue down this path of generalities, of evaluations that could be much more constructive and meaningful for all of us. We have to remain focused and determined to move the city in a positive direction. If you are truly interested in retaining a city manager who has the experience, education, expertise, and integrity to manage the city, who will always be honest and forthright with you on policy matters, even if you don't like what you hear, who is fair, uniform, and consistent in his actions, and who is an independent thinker and willing to stand up for what is proper rather than what is politically expedient, then I respectfully ask you to halt this process and allow me to get back to doing my job tomorrow. Thank you for your kind attention and consideration.
Thank you, Mr. McCleary. Like I said, I know there's a lot of passion in this room, but we're going to ask now that you only speak when you're called to the podium. There is a 3-minute time limit. Those wishing to speak on this matter only, please raise your hand, ma'am.
Shouldn't there be a point of order where you were discussing when you limited the speeches or whatever you want to call it on special occasions, there should be 5 minutes put on that? There might be some people that are, to that position.
Well, sir, with a full house, we're going to go with 3 minutes tonight. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Cynthia Grace Gargan. I live at 28367 Maplewood Street. This council for the past 2 years has been telling the citizens of Garden City that they, the council, are working to rebuild our trust, their honesty, and transparency within the community. And how do you expect us to trust you when council members, Mr. Fetter, Mr. Kerwin, they tell us we don't need to know the reasons for dismissal. You give Mr. McCleary an above average to an average performance review, yet you suspend him with no explanation. The police chief acting city manager states to the council at the last meeting that he has spoken to the citizen who made the complaint about the problem at Maplewood and Harrison about the rats. The so-called Epic Center was his quote. Yet, as of today, I have not spoke with you, and you have not spoke with me. Mr. Jack Barnes has not spoke with me. There has been no communication from the city other than from the mayor or Angelo. When we have problems with our trash hauler, it has been Republic. It has been Mr. McCleary and the mayor who have gone to bat for the citizens. With the rats, it was Mr. McCleary. When I had a problem with the situation, I went to City Hall. It was Mr. McCleary who came out and answered those questions and directed me as to how to get things resolved. None of you have showed an interest. None of you have even spoke to me. None of you have done anything to correct the problem. My vote certainly won't be for those who talk the talk but won't walk the walk and hide behind closed meetings and secret doors. I doubt if any one of you will be reelected unless you start telling us the truth instead of what you think we want to hear or what you think we need to know. Thank you.
Let's please keep the applause down. I know there's a lot of passion, but we got a lot of people that want to speak tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. King.
Good evening, Mayor, Council, Police Chief. You look very dapper tonight. As I look around, I thought I was almost in a street light assessment meeting, but I see that we're not. I've heard a lot of anecdotal information. I've read a lot of anecdotal information. And all that really comes down to is he said, she said. The fact of the matter is that the council and Mr. McCleary came up with a set of guidelines for his performance evaluation. It was mutual. I know that you meet on a frequent basis and go over Mr. McCleary's performance. I've been through terminations before. They better be documented. If there was any problems with Mr. McCleary's performance, those problems should have been communicated to him by documentation. It should be dated. Everybody should know about it. I'm appalled that there are 4 people who evidently know and 3 people who don't know. I can't understand how that can possibly be. You all sit in on his performance review. You all discuss it. You all figure out what's going on. Everybody should have any documentation that went to Mr. McCleary for his failure to perform his job. That It just blows my mind that that does not appear to be the case. Mr. Fetter says we don't have a right to know. Maybe that's true, maybe it isn't. I believe we do have a right to know. Maybe not the specifics, but we need to know where he's failing. Generalities, that's fine. There are people who seem to know what's going on who are not a part of this body. I've received 3 phone calls from people who have told me things. Again, it's anecdotal. It doesn't carry any weight. All I do know is if this leads, if you continue to be on the path that you are on, and that is your right to do that, if you continue down that road and you decide to terminate Mr. McCleary's performance or his job, and it leads us to a wrongful discharge suit, I will not be happy. I would suspect that many of the people who are behind me right now, physically not.
You have 30 seconds, Mr. King.
Physically will not be happy either. I just request that you take this very seriously. If you don't have the documentation, you cannot terminate his employment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
My name is Christopher Schmidt. I live at 33604 Alvin. I've been a Garden City homeowner for over 40 years and consider myself part of the silent majority. I've never been to a council meeting. I watch them on TV. I vote in the elections, but I'm not happy. I've never expressed my opinions publicly before this evening. I'd much rather be home watching the Tigers. To the best of my recollection, in the most recent council election, our new council members campaigned on a platform of more transparency in city government. I read this in the Observer. We're sick of not knowing what's going on. And that's why you got voted in, because other people were not open and above board. I'm concerned that the council has been following the lead of a few outspoken residents in making their decisions. Firing a city employee and terminating his contract is a serious, irreversible step and should never be done without just cause. With my limited knowledge of the situation, everything I have ever seen Mr. McCleary do has been done with the best interest of Garden City and its residents foremost in his mind. A few years ago, the Garden City Council made a very unwise decision by not negotiating with a contractor. We're all paying for that today.
Now, you can only speak if you're at the podium.
I would hate to see you make another rash decision. That's how we ended up with 12 mills on the ballot. 12 mills was absurd. We all knew that. And when you got it straight, we voted for it. That's what we wanted, honesty. We've elected you to represent us in making the best decisions for all the residents, not just the ones who regularly attend the council meetings. Sometimes patience is best. If you're not 100% sure about the solution tonight, pray about it and wait until you are sure. Is it best to make a change now?
You have 30 seconds.
Or wait until his contract expires? I ask only one thing of you. Do what you think will benefit Garden City and its residents the most. Thank you. I appreciate your help.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Hi, Ed Cable, Balmoral Street. I thought the city manager was doing a pretty good job. We've got a balanced budget. We got the millage through. It's tough. I understand that. But when I watched that August 27th council meeting, I was really disappointed. I thought the city was going in the right direction. Now I'm not so sure. The only thing I can say is don't shoot the messenger. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir, front row.
My name is Ralph Romance out of 252 Ross in Garden City. I've been in the city here for 47 years. I went through the council before when we had all the problem. We had the lawsuit. I do not want another one. If this turns out to be another one, I think I'm going to move out of Garden City. I'm sick and tired of people doing things and we don't know what's going on. Nobody will tell us. I can't read anything in the paper. I'm frustrated with the whole situation. I don't think he should be terminated, period.
Thank you, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I'm sorry, thank you. Nancy Buckley on Pierce. I've been a Garden City resident since 1987. Absolutely love this city. Love the police force and the fire department. Mr. McCleary, the one thing I hear from you is you are 100% professional. To have our city with a balanced budget, retain fire and police, all the other items that Mr. McCleary is on, supports, works with, and have to look at that council meeting from television and see four people who said they're doing it right by terminating the manager. The right way to even have this presented would have been the four people would have said, this is what we want to do based on their rights to speak. They should have called the other council members and said, this is what we're planning. But to come into a council meeting and surprise the mayor, to surprise the city manager with this crap is unprofessional. The professional that's in this room is Mr. McCleary, chief of police, the fire chief, the mayor, and the council members that want to work together. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Ms. Bondovitz.
Yes, it is.
Linda Bonovitz, 962 West Rose. I've been a resident of Garden City since 1962. My parents moved here because Garden City schools had a great reputation. I can't believe what's going on here. I haven't heard one valid reason to fire the city manager. We finally have a real city manager who tells it like it is, not what you want to hear. I'm very disappointed by the actions of the four of you on council. You had my vote before, but if you vote to fire him based on the information you have given us, which is literally nothing, you will not ever again have my vote. I plan to tell family and friends why I won't vote for you. I'm asking at least one of you to change your vote. Mr. Cordy, I'm personally asking you to change your vote. I was shocked when you voted to suspend our city manager. Ms. Squires, you ran because you wanted to bring common sense to council, and you have. Ms. Lynch, Mr. Walker, Ms. Squires, you represent my husband and I very well on council. I normally attend school board meetings, but tonight I'm here because it is more important. National PTA has a theme, Every Child, One Voice, which means they speak for every child, whether parents are members or not. Four of you on this council seem to be representing a small group of people, not the majority of Garden City. I haven't spoke to one person in favor of firing our city manager. We aren't in a deficit. He does an excellent job. He has respect of his employees and is very knowledgeable. Why are you doing this? If there are problems, discuss them. Put them on probation, if and only if it's warranted. Another thing that was mentioned, that the budget was 2 weeks late. Whoopee. His mom was sick and dying. Where was your compassion? We are still in hard times and hard decisions have had to be made. I'm asking you, please, do not vote to fire Darwin McCleary. He's done a good job in hard economic times. Mr. McCleary, please do not let a small group of people represent all of Garden City, because they don't. Thank you for all that you have done for the residents of Garden City.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Bill Abbott. I live on Hennepin. I'd like to thank each and every one of you for the hard work that you do. I know that some days are like this, some days have been more difficult than this, and some days have been better than this, but I know that you face a lot of scrutiny with every decision you make, and it's not easy, so thank you. I'd also like to thank the police chief and the fire chief. I've had the unlucky happenings to have both of your outfits at my house in years past. I've been in Garden City better part of the last 45 years, and I'm happy to be here. I know that some of these board meetings got pretty testy, and I, like the other gentleman that spoke earlier, this is the first time I've been here. I'd like to share, and I'd also like to thank Mr. McClary for the work he's done. I don't know that much about it, but I'll share one story about him that I had the opportunity to be a part of. When he was holding the town hall meetings for the police and fire millage, they were here in this building, well, next door, I guess. And his presentation was professional. It was complete. I understood, and I don't understand finances that well. My wife does the finances at our house. But I understood what he was saying, and it was important to me. I just retired. I don't have a whole lot of extra money to give to anybody. And it was important to me to try to understand it. He made it very clear to me what the costs were, what the services were going to be if we made it, and what the services we would lose would be if we lost it. And I was happy and proud that we, as a group, voted for it. He was very polite. He was knowledgeable. He was considerate. And I was the only person at that meeting. And it was as if there were 300 people at that meeting. He treated me no different than, and the meeting was no less than if it were a complete, full group of people. And I appreciated that. I also don't understand how, and many people have said something very close to this. I only read in the Observer that there hasn't been communication for a year and a half. I just retired, as I said, as an educator, and was in every part of education. I know that you can't run anything without communication. At the bottom of every application, you fill in, thank you. Communication skills is on every application. And if you don't communicate, you can't get anything done. I would fully support keeping Mr. McClary. I think he's done a great job. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm Nancy Bailey. I moved to Garden City when I was 11 years old in 1949. I don't know what the four council members, like we all say, we have no idea what their complaints are with Mr. McClary. All I can say is everybody makes mistakes. The council members, the mayor, the lawyer, Mr. McClary, myself, we all make mistakes. I saw something in the Free Press as a letter to the editor, and in the letter it said, if we got rid of our children who make mistakes, our spouses, friends, our jobs, or ourselves, when efforts or expectations were less than hoped for, nothing would ever be accomplished. Well, I work for the federal government. In the federal government, you get in a performance evaluation every year. I got one every single year. And if there was something wrong on your evaluation and they felt you were really not doing so well, you had a period of time to improve. There was a certain amount of time that you had to improve, and you had the right to improve. And if the federal government did not give you the time to improve, then you could file a grievance, and usually all those people who filed those grievances got their jobs back because the government didn't give them a chance to improve. So, I mean, I'm on Mr. McClary's side, but I have no idea what the problem is here. But all I can say is to the city council, this is a man's livelihood. This is his reputation, his work reputation. Also, what the city council, I feel, should most be important of is what is best for the city. What is best for the citizens? We don't want any more, you know, legal problems and any more millions of dollars to pay for another streetscape type of thing. But anyway, I'm just saying, whatever the problem is, I don't know what the rules are in a city government because I work for the U.S. government, and they do have certain rules. People do have a chance to improve their performance, whatever the problems are. Thank you. But anyway, I'm just saying, we don't want to get rid of people for no reason. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Bill Sabrolia. I've been a resident since 1965. It's not too long ago we had a special meeting for a special assessment on lighting. Approximately 95 to 97% of the audience and the general comments were against having a special assessment. And I believe the city manager at that time was present and acting as attending interim city manager. Now, if he wants to come clean, it has to be said by me, and I believe he was the culprit that take it out of the general fund and give a special assessment. Now, when you do stuff like that, I think it's just a shifty maneuver to get it from the general fund, and you've got approximately a half a million to play with. And that bill is gone. You don't have to worry about it anymore. If it raises like it is now, it's all right, raise the assessment. Whose benefit is that? Not the residents, that's for sure. All I'm saying is, you four who voted for the dismissal, stick to your guns, and if it's valid, don't let nobody change your mind. Because I think we can get anybody, maybe half the price, to make shifty moves. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Thank you, Harriet. I'm Harriet Batchick, and I live on Rush Street in Garden City, and I've been a resident since 1957. You've made a lot of the comments that I would have liked to make, and as our time is limited, I had to cut it. So I would like to, one of the things I'd like to say, that each budget recommendation that Mr. McClary made, there had to be a council member that went one upped him and said, we don't need to spend that much money, and they cut it. On the last one, his recommendation was 4.1. You said we're only spending 3.5. We've already gone into contingency fund twice. He knows his numbers. I'm a retired accountant, so I know a few numbers too. And in regard to his paying what our previous person said we could get him for half the price, well, if you take his salary and divide it by our 27,800 people, which his salary is about 140, give or take, he costs each resident $5 a year. And for the job he's doing, I think it's a pretty darn good job. And I don't think we could get a better job done by someone spending twice as much money. I've been at meetings with him in regard to planning, and he is extremely knowledgeable in all planning, all the ordinances and any state laws and anything to do with city planning. And he knows his business very well. At one of the meetings, we had a small meeting. One of our planning people passed out because of his illness. They called EMS, and Mr. McClary stayed with him, rode in the ambulance to the hospital till his wife got there and made sure that he was accompanied. All his knowledge on the budget and the municipal accounting, which he's been called down on for accounting, and it's not municipal accounting. You have to know that's a totally different ballgame. And all the things, the budget negotiations he's done with the unions and with the other municipalities in order to coordinate costs, all this he's done, and in order to get somebody to get up to speed for all he's done for us and with us, it would take a lot of time and cost a lot of money to even find a new person that's as knowledgeable as he is. So nobody's perfect, like it was stated, and we all make mistakes.
Harriet, your time is up.
Well, one more quick thing. Unless you can tell me something, until you can really tell me something, I think we need to change a partial council.
I'm gonna have to ask you to sit down. Okay. We got a lot of people here.
Okay, well.
Thank you.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Good evening. Mayor Walker, 30-year resident, Ken Stewart.
Your name?
Ken Stewart.
Okay.
And I'm a little upset. The despicable and reprehensible handling of Mr. McCleary's departure is a financial threat to every man, woman, and child in Garden City. We are currently paying some extra $150 a month in taxes because of the last $15 million debacle, where this council back then failed to honor a contract. And two of those people are still on board. And here we are broaching deja vu. Getting proper legal advice and doing the proper thing does not stop 12 honest men in a jury box from putting the city down financially. I think McCleary's speech was smooth, rehearsed. I wouldn't doubt there was a bevy of attorneys there at $700 an hour applauding it. Because that's what we're looking at. Another one. And you're sitting there looking so smug all this evening, disturbs me even more. I'm talking to Mr. Kerwin. Where is the separation clause? Where is the separation clause that's a part of Mr. McCleary's contract? Why aren't we using that? I know you're aware of it. That would be the proper way of going about this, and do it through the front door, not this bully board backdoor policy that you guys have adopted. Thank you for your time.
Yes, sir.
Jim Patterson, 31551 James Street, Garden City. And I started to time my presentation out at home, and it ran well over 3 minutes. So I have cut it way back. And I have 9 copies here, one for Ms. Bettis, one for each council member, and one for Darren McCleary. To cut it short, the council has lost my vote of confidence. My performance evaluation of the council will be at the next election when their terms expire. And I voted for 5 out of 7 of you. It is my opinion that the city manager, Darren McCleary, was suspended without due process afforded him by the city manager employment agreement and the Garden City Council rules of procedure. The attached is my rationale for the council to review. As I said, I timed this at home and found out it wasn't going to be enough time. So I agree with the 3-minute rule. I believe that formalizing my opinions in writing is constructive notice and trust that the council will take their time to review them. I welcome your comments. Please advise if you have any questions, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? Mr. Weiser.
Good
It appears to me that the major complaint of many of the people here is regarding the process by which this is being undertaken. All of that could have been clarified. The chair should have and can still ask Mr. Cronin to give his opinion of the procedure that is under process at this time as being the usual process and entirely proper. Entirely proper. I hope the chair will exercise and ask Mr. Cronin that. My belief of a good city manager is an administrator who works in the best interests of the city and its residents, young, old, and those in between. With this in mind, I feel the city manager has failed us miserably. He has shown to me to be arrogant, uncooperative, less than truthful, one-sided, and not worthy of continued employment with this community. He has been respectful, and that's a personal note, because he was disrespectful at a council meeting by words to my wife, and we talked to him about it. Further, if he has any monies for car usage during his suspended period, if he has accepted any, I think then to the list of reasons that I feel we do not want him as our city manager representing our community, add the words greed or lack of morality. I thank you.
Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. My name is Linda Skorup, and I live in Garden City. I don't think too many people will really question that he hasn't done a good job on some things. I know we've worked very hard with all the unions to get the pay cuts and everything else for people. But I really have to question his character when it comes to the integrity of what he really does. When he was here, well, we talked about him as far as hiring. I was really kind of against what his severance pay was. I thought that was more of a, this is what I need, this is what I want, not what the city needs. The city was already in dire problems with the expenses. Also, while working with the unions and having everybody else reduce his pay, or reduce their pay, I didn't see him volunteering to reduce any of his pay. I didn't see him, when it came to the compensation plan with the 20%, to give his 20% until 2014, when all the others, the majority of the city employees had to give theirs up or start paying theirs in 2012. I really question what he's really doing for the city. I realize that's not gonna make a big dent in budget revenue, but it's making a gesture saying, I'm for the city, I'm working with the city, I've worked with the unions to make pay cuts, I'm willing to do it too, but he didn't stand up to do that. Also, creative accounting can be done to balance almost anything. I've been in the financial accounting industry, whatever you want to call it, almost all my life, and anything can be balanced. When you take out expenditures such as the lighting, you can definitely reduce your budget. And then all of a sudden it's like, well, we have to have the citizens pay for it because we didn't put that in our budget. Now we're being told, well, that isn't enough. It kind of makes me wonder how you came up with those figures. I did go to him once on the water, how they came up with how we're being paid, how we pay for our water. The answer I got, which unfortunately I couldn't bring because my computer crashed last year, but it was not how you came up with how much the gallons that were being charged. You came up with the cubic feet in everything else. And I guess the cubic footage and I guess maybe per gallon or per 1,000 gallons.
You have 30 seconds, ma'am.
So I guess I really have to question how much the city really means to you, and you weren't willing to take any kind of pay cuts. For your gas, I don't know of anybody who gets paid to drive to work. Why wasn't there like an expense account set up? When you go to a meeting, you put in and then you get paid how much you have for mileage, not just this overall gas budget.
Okay, ma'am, your time is up. Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
My name's John Murray. I live on Lathers. I'm a victim of the Garden City school systems, and the things that I remember most was like the year of our commencement in 72, the winds were blowing. That summer, we had the terrorists kill Jewish people at the Olympics. Our country started changing, and I feel that there's people here that have education and abilities to make sound decisions, but they're not using them. As an employee of Ford's, Mr. Fretter, you know of ISO 9000s. There's procedures on how we dismiss people. Mr. Walker, you strong-arm this meeting all the time. That's one of the reasons why I'm here. And we have a situation right now where we have slandered that man by the way we're doing it, because technically, the way I see it, there's only four individuals that know why he's being dismissed. And you as the mayor have not put out any of that information for us. So my question is where are we going to find the accountability to do the proper things? He might be fireable. I've worked on both sides of labor as a representative and as a boss, whatever you want to call it. And I know you have to have procedures. You have to write them up. There has to be a contract. There had to be some way of what he could be fired for. And most of them times are for like thievery, defamation of character, something of, you know, where usually the police get involved. Right now, he's a free man. So I really think you as a council members need to reevaluate this and learn from your mistake, because you made us look very foolish. Because this should have never made it into the papers. I'm embarrassed because of your actions. And you need to clean it up, and I would like you to rescind that motion, put the man back to work, somebody create a committee, and you need to use the guidelines you have with your union contracts with our employees, and that's how you have to dismiss your salaried individuals. That is the best understanding I have. If I'm incorrect, we do have a lawyer here today that can clear it up for us. And I do believe that we should get some sort of input from him, because we don't want another lawsuit.
You have 30 seconds, sir.
And all I can say is, Jaylene Lynch, I'm glad you're back with us, because I think you got a raw deal on the politics of this town.
Anybody else? Mr. Chico?
Good evening, Council. How you doing? I haven't been here in a long time. It's probably been about a year, and I've watched from TV. And I have to say that you guys have been through a lot. I know that. And but I'm kind of disappointed in a lot of people that have come up here. My biggest concern right now is probably more selfish. It's basically, as a citizen of Garden City, I have a home, and I know we're paying big time on another lawsuit that's in our history. I don't want another lawsuit. I don't want to have any lawsuit come out of this council due to ignorance of the law. Now, I understand we have four people that have basically committed to this process. Hopefully, we'll get to learn more down the road. Hopefully not. I don't want to get a lawsuit because you guys went out and exposed a lot of the information that we weren't supposed to know about. Because I honestly believe that when you go to your next employer, nobody should be knowing why this guy got fired, to be honest with you. Just know that he was relieved and that was it. So my biggest thing is that I'm more selfish. That's why I've come here to kind of like say that I don't want to see a lawsuit. I understand that he serves at the discretion of the council. Basically, he don't work for me. He works for you guys. I understand that as a citizen, because that's the way it's wrote. But having said that, it is almost like a political position for him to be here, is that, you know, you accept the rules that are set forth for you for your employment, right? So having said that, you know, he's got to make at least four people on his council happy. And apparently that hasn't happened. But let's go back to the lawsuit. You four people better have your stuff in line here, because I do not want to have to worry about another lawsuit. I'll keep saying that word for a while. But anyway, I've seen other people come up here and they've had this big old dance for the last year of trying to get rid of the city manager as well. And I keep hearing he makes too much. I got to hope that he's been benchmarked against other cities for his cost for the city, right? I've heard other rumors where he's got to make $1,000 more than a police chief or something. And I looked through the city's rules and all that. I couldn't find anything like that. So I'm hoping we benchmarked him. So he's getting competitive pay. So I wish the person that keeps coming up here and spouting that garbage would just stop. It just gets old. That's all I really want to say, is that, you know, it's a lot of work to run a city. You know, I feel bad for the guy, you know, but he's in the arena. He's in, okay? So he's got to make four people happy tonight, and hopefully he does that. Because I kind of like the guy. I kind of endorsed him when he came on board.
You have 30 seconds, Mr. Chico.
And so that's all I have to say, really. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? Mr. Bowers, Keith Bowers.
Keith Bowers, Sheridan Street, Garden City. I'm not going to come up here to argue with you. There's several of you up here that I have the utmost respect for because of your law enforcement background, your military background, where you've been, and what you've done. But I was once told that you can do anything you want in politics as long as you don't take credit for it. Somebody up there really needs to consider if they want to take credit for something or not. I mean, this has ended up being a bad prom date right now. We're supposed to be moving forward. We just took 10 steps back. And we're going to take 10 more back. And everybody keeps talking lawsuit. Everybody keeps talking, you know, the Wayne Oakland contracting thing years ago. These are two different things. The guy's job is tough. Everybody's job up there is tough. Mr. Federer, I don't know if you work for Ford or not. Somebody said you did? I don't know. I'm just saying. But everybody here has worked for somewhere that has an SOP about how they hire, how they fire, how they do exit interviews. And if this is what we're going to do to our city manager, if you guys do get rid of Mr. Cleary, maybe there's things that we can change in our city charter to where the residents can help out on evaluating the next city manager. And the residents can evaluate the people that run for city council halfway through their term to find out if they're needed to stay or not. That's where we're at. This is a great city. This is an excellent city. And we have to keep it going that way. But just remember, if you can be persuaded, or if you can be coaxed into something, or if somebody can tell you something that's a little fuzzy, don't take credit for it. It's going to stick with you for a long time. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Cheryl Carton, Garden City resident for over 40 years. Keep talking about how emotional it is, and anybody that knows me knows how emotional I get. But I'm here to support Darwin McCleary. I have just been appalled by how this whole process has gone down. And no, I don't expect to know any personal matters about what goes on behind closed doors. But Mr. McCleary has done a great job for our city. And it is my understanding that Mr. Kerwin has not even had taken the time to talk to Mr. McCleary directly over the last year and a half. If you've had issues with him, if you've heard of communication, everything involves around communication, and it doesn't sound like you have very good communication skills. You want to suspend the city manager, but you have to think what is best for our city. And I think keeping Mr. McCleary as our city manager is what's best for our city. And I hope you think about it before you make your decision, because I can assure you that if you do not have the full support and do what is best for our city, that come election time, you won't be here anymore. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Gary Parton, Catherine, Garden City. Well, I don't know about you, but I think the people have spoken, and I hope the four of you are listening and listening well. I am here in support of Darren McCleary. Hope you reconsider your vote on this and reinstate him immediately, because if you don't, you won't have my vote.
Yes, sir.
Brett Schmidt, 6621 Hubbard. Been here my whole life. This is ridiculous. Not only has this council separated our city, they're separating the things that are progressing our city forward. Mr. McCleary has done an outstanding job. To insult us, the people that elected you into the positions that you're in, and say that we don't deserve an answer, explanation on why you're doing what you're doing, really? I mean, is this what we elected these people to do? Not at all. Our city manager spends continuous hours he's not paid for here in our city taking care of the issues that need to get taken care of. You guys say, oh, well, he's on a 4-day work week. I've worked overtime, whether it's 6 days or whether it's 3 days. The guy works more hours in those 4 days than most people work in five. Not only does he do that, he takes on the positions when the layoffs happened, five other departments that he has to account for and he has to oversee. You guys have this arrogance about yourself that you want to come out to us and insult our intelligence by saying that we don't have a right to know. Really? We elected all of you. We won't elect you again. If this happens tonight, all four of you guys don't plan on getting reelected. I will do everything in my power for the next year to kibosh all your campaigns and do whatever I need to do to make sure people are knowledgeable about what you stand for and the hidden agendas, Mr. Fetter, Mr. Kerwin, Mrs. Dodge, and Cordy, I don't even know where you got pulled into this. I mean, I just feel bad for you. I want my city chief over here, the chief of police, to be a police officer. I don't want a guy who does sprinklers every day working on my car. I want my police chief to be a police chief. I want my city manager educated and be a city manager, period. I don't want a guy who was a police chief and now we're gonna retrain him over here because it's cheaper money. We end up losing money in the long run. The way you guys have railroaded this guy, the way you guys went behind the other council members' backs, that's insulting to us. And then to sit there with the audacity and the arrogance that you have and tell us that we don't have a right to know appalls me. I have spent the last month trying to get every citizen I can talk to understand the importance of our city manager and how great a job he's done and Mrs. Bettis, and without the two of them, we have nothing, period. And I'm so happy to see everybody has turned out the way they have. I hope you guys make the right decision. But I can tell you this, if you make the wrong decision, you won't be sitting there next year. Thank you.
Gomer Goins, it's quite obvious that you folks have never seen a city council like this and seen them operate. What you have seen here is two new people to this council to give some support to Jody Dodge and Jim Kerwin, and these folks are living up to their campaign promise. They are planning on putting this city back on its feet. Now, you folks out here, you can come in here and talk about sympathy this, sympathy that. But you have never had to work with this man. I'd say here in these city council meetings, that guy lied like a sheep-killing dog, and we can prove it by the tapes. And people said up here.
No name calling, please.
We're not going to tolerate that.
Yep. Right. No name calling.
No name calling.
Please, sir, only speak when you're at the podium. Mr. Goins? That's your first and final warning. No name calling.
Well, if he lies, you won't, don't want me to tell you about him lying. And it's been proved, and people on this council sit up and say he's doing a good job. Look what he done to the city employees. Put that on their 20% on their health care. Never give them the opportunity to opt out. But I tell you this, you're looking at four people up there on that council, stands three top tall, and with the people out here in the communities, and I say to you folks here, these people come up here making these idle threats, don't mount to a hill of beans. Because it takes a lot of folks to get these people elected, and these people are using their head and they, instead of their heart. And when you got to make some decisions, these people are not afraid to get up there and make those decisions. And also with this, now
you have 30 seconds, Mr. Goins. Huh? You got 30 seconds.
J. Lee Lynch, you are a very highly educated woman. You've taught school for a long time. You know people. You can read people like a book. Of course, some of the pages may be tore out. But you know, and I know, that man was not doing his job.
Mr. Wallace?
Buddy Wallace. I've lived in this city since 1962. I coached sports for 29 years, baseball, softball, basketball. I want to tell you something. All these people back here don't remember about the Headley override. Had it not been for this lawyer that we have right now, we would be on a Headley override that would never expire. And that was from the city manager. He said, there's no other way. Mr. Cronin showed us how there was a way. And we're not stuck. We're stuck with 3 years, 4 years, but not a lifetime. That went on forever. And for all these people that making threats about you're not going to get reelected, don't pay no attention to them. There's 27,000 people in here. And I'm telling you that I get more phone calls in a week than what showed up here and there, all for the fearless foursome, okay? You can believe it or not, that's up to you. But anyway, talk about his love for the city. He never gave any, his trips for Garden City was based on five for his car expense. Never gave any of it back. That's a breach of contract right there. Hey, he never said he cut everybody else's wages, but he didn't take any cuts. No cuts. And if you was on his favorite list, you'd get everything on the agenda. I've sat here in the council meeting, and if he wasn't, you didn't get anything put on there. I made a mistake once, and I criticized somebody. And I was wrong. That guy is the most, as far as I'm concerned, vindictive person that I have ever seen in my life. I've never seen anyone so more vindictive and so more selfish in all my life.
Please only speak if you're at the podium.
Thank you, Mayor. But anyway, we got to get on with it. You got to fire him. I guess a lot of people didn't read the charter on the right way to fire somebody. We got an attorney up there that saved her guns before about the Headley override. I'm sure that he's in contact with these people. He's not going to let us have a lawsuit.
You have 30 seconds, Mr. Wallace.
Thank you.
Mrs. Weissick?
What I see here tonight is democracy in process. I have come to council meetings when you were a councilman mayor and Jim Plakas was the mayor. Me and Baca, Mr. Bacher, only two people at the council meetings. They were trying to put $1 million tent in the Kroger parking lot for the farmers market. I was against it. I thought we couldn't afford it. We didn't need it. A farmer's market don't belong in a building. It belongs out in the open. It belongs in the park. It's because we're one city, and if it was in the park, it would bring lots of people into the city, which would benefit the DDA more than it being in the why that Kroger parking lot has to be everything. But anyway, I was tired of coming here alone. But I came anyway, and I stuck to my guns, and I don't know what happened in the end, but the tent didn't go up in the Kroger parking lot. You know, Kroger's parking lot, the businesses should take care of
it. Your comments should be on Mr. McCleary. That's what we're talking about.
Well, I'm talking about democracy and progress, and I'm glad everybody came. I hope you continue coming, because I get pretty tired of coming up here. And you know, there's all kinds of things said, but we've had 12 city managers come and go. Some been let go, some went on their own. We had one that came, he met with mayor and council, went to lunch and went home, never saw him again. I mean, this too will pass, but what you've got to do now is try to keep this city together. You're dividing everybody up. The forehead, every right to make that opinion. They cannot go in and tell the other three because they'll be in a break the Open Meetings Act. Mr. Fetter's already been charged with that. I know exactly how that's done. When my husband was on council, some of them got together and said he was breaking the Open Meetings Act because one time after a council meeting, we all went for coffee. So one of us had to sit on the other side of the building. So that this happens. What else happens is some councilmen don't get things from the city manager. I know how that game is played. I know when my husband was a councilman, the city manager would leave lots of things out of his package that he didn't want him to know. And that's been done, all the time. And that's how the process works. And you have four votes, three votes. That's how it works.
Your time is up.
And you cannot destroy the city and separate the city and break it apart any more than it's broken apart.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Derek Parton. I've been a Garden City resident all 23 years I've lived here. First off, I'll be honest, I'm not been involved in my community as much as I should in city government. However, seeing and hearing what has transpired recently regarding Mr. McCleary, I had to come tonight to show my support and gratitude for this man. I don't know Mr. McCleary personally, but I was honored enough to be listening in on my dad's community podcast to an interview he conducted with Mr. McCleary. And to sum everything up, I was greatly intrigued and impressed with how well he conducted himself as a professional and ethical gentleman during such a conflicting time for our city. This is not what our city needs right now, as we need to really move forward and work together. If these four council members up here proceed to go through with termination based on information that the general public has been provided with, it will be a very poor decision. And in my opinion, I'm sure in the opinions of many in the community, in the audience tonight, no man deserves to be treated this way, and I'm in full support of Darren McCleary, and he needs to be put back where he belongs, and that is running our city. Thank you.
Hi, Cheryl Stepanian, 6643 Sharon Street. Good evening, Mayor and Council. The city manager has managed to keep us solvent during these difficult economic times and has shown competent leadership abilities. I see no reason, unless someone explains otherwise, to dismiss him as a city manager. We, the citizens, even more than Mr. McCleary, deserves his continued service to the city. Thank you.
Hi, Marty Nash, 31462 Balmoral. I want to give my support to Darwin tonight. And I just don't feel good about this. I was an hour late to the meeting because I had to work overtime today. But I understand that he got up here and said that he'd like to come back. I think you should give him the chance to come back. Work out your differences. If you're looking to send a message, I'm sure he heard it. I'd like to see us all get on the same track. Start again. Also, this is pretty drastic. I think if you're gonna, as a city, try to fire somebody like this, you should have 6 of the 7 votes on the council to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Buckner.
Al Buckner, I'm not going to use my speech tonight. I'm going to tell you I'm upset too, and I'm disappointed that you only have this many come out. This guy is so loved, you only have this many citizens come out. I'm here to tell you the four, stick to your guns. You got more behind you than what's here. Okay? Remember some things. Remember how this guy did not follow through on your task that you asked him to do. How this man over here in 2 weeks took your issue you were trying to get through in months. Yep, we may have to pay him 6 months of salary. But after that, we save $852 a day. This man over here is only getting $35 bump in pay. And already, he's not only got your task done, but in the paper, it showed Barnes out working. That right there alone is worth a raise for this guy. First time in 20 years I've seen Barnes working. Somebody got it on film. So I'm telling you, forget about what they're saying. Are they here every 2 weeks listening to you? No. Friends of the mayor and of the other council are like fleas on a dog. They're there for a free ride.
Anybody else? Mr. Neves.
Thank you. Jim Neves. I live on Central Street. I've been here since 1953. This is the lowest point I've ever seen the city. The last time it was is when the mayor got shot in 1957.
Don't go there.
No. I look at a good friend in Jim. Don't know you, don't know him, don't know her. But I want you to put yourself in a position of that man over there. Did you really give him every opportunity to rise? Did you go through the whole thing, the whole gamut? No, I don't think he's done it, you know. You want me to vote for you and you and you? Never happen. Never happen. Because you can't respect people. Not only him, everybody that's out here. No respect. But you want us to respect you. How can we do it? Could you give me an answer? I don't think either four of you could give me an answer. As far as I'm concerned, you're dragging the city down big time. I hope you all think of what you've done. Because you'll never get my vote.
Anybody else?
David, thanks to Brian. You got a lot of, I know you have enough, but I got to have enough brains to figure out a lot of that stuff that was said about the Headley, the lighting. You have to have enough brains to know that that's all a bunch of bull. I know it's a bunch of bull. I told you about the lighting many times. Everybody was, put it on a tax, put it on a tax. Yeah, put it on a tax, let David pay 50, and my friend back here pay 40, the same lights. That's the tax thing you got in the city now with this property tax crap. But anyway, like I said, you're getting a lot of misinformation about a lot of stuff up here. And he's taking blame for a lot of stuff, like the 20% for the city employees. That's a state mandate. He had nothing to do with it. Everybody, he didn't have a choice. So I don't know why everybody's following me with that. He even gave an extra week to figure out if they wanted to opt out of it. So I guess you should be thanking him instead of coming up here and jumping on him all the time for all the misinformation you're putting out about the man. And my friends back here are going to jump on me when I get through. So, but that'd be all right. We're still going to be friends. We'll argue about it and we'll shake hands after. We'll still be friends. Thank you.
Anybody else? Last call, I'm going to close the public hearing. Okay, I will close the public hearing at 8:27 p.m.
Mayor?
Mr. Kerwin.
I move to approve the final resolution to remove the city manager.
Support.
We got a motion from Mr. Kerwin and support from Councilmember Dodge. Discussion from council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Cordy.
I'd like to make a brief statement.
Go ahead.
There have been some statements made publicly that I would like to address now. I want to go on record that I did not meet with these three council members at any time to discuss the removal of this city manager. There has been a fair amount of discussion regarding the city manager's evaluation, as well as tonight. I would like to clarify this rating. When I do the math, he was consistently, and I mean consistently, rated below average. Regarding grievances, I wouldn't know. The city manager does not share this information with me. When I would inquire, and especially on a particular item, I had one, I was told grievances are handled administratively. I'm not here to micromanage. All I wanted to do was have an update once in a while, because if a grievance becomes a, it keeps going down the line and someone turns out and goes to arbitration, that does cost our city money. And I would like to know before it reaches that point. It never did. Many times tonight, I've also heard about city services we have. Our thanks to the good citizens of Garden City who voted for the police and fire millage this past May, or year ago May. We have a balanced budget because it's required by state law. Not only he submits a balanced budget to us, but we must approve it. It has been stated no reasons have been given for his suspension. In my short time on this council, I have approached the city manager on several issues. Whenever I have approached the city manager with citizens' concerns that have come to me personally, either by way of phone or by email, I've yet to get a satisfactory answer. Biggest one that I have concerns about a new Kroger gas station and how they obtained approvals. I was told that the council was not to be involved itself in this matter until it becomes before the council. Well, when I receive phone calls, I'd like to know how to respond to those people. The execution of the current year employee benefit package was handled poorly. I've been accused of not being transparent, but when in reality, this is just one of my issues with this city manager. When I've asked repeatedly from this table for budget information, there's always an excuse not to make it available for me. As a city council person, one of my biggest concerns is city blight. When I have residents continuously complain about the same property, I have to wonder why this house continually falls through the cracks. And when we are approached by our city manager, he's not given us a reasonable answer to date. The city administration approved this city hall to be open 3 days a week and closed during lunchtime. If it was not for this council to push this issue, we probably would still have the same kind of hours. For those of you who know me, you know I do not make off-the-cuff decisions or spur-of-the-moment decisions. I do not appreciate being labeled with one group or another. I will continue to review all the information and facts and make my decision based on the good of all citizens of Garden City. Thank you, Mayor.
Anybody else on council?
I do, Mr. Mayor. Like Mr. Cordy, I do want to respond. I've said it before, and I want to make sure everybody understands. I do not vote to align myself with anybody. I hope you've seen that in me. I have done nothing for the vote. Nothing. I had a very wise man tell me when I was running for office, he wanted to know if I was crazy. And he said, if you do your job, you'll never get reelected. But over time, you'll be appreciated. I don't really care. I've said it before, I mean it. I don't care if I get reelected. So threaten, I don't care. If I run and you don't vote for me. But I will do what I feel is right. And let me tell you why. I have said it was nobody's business. And that's because of my 30 years in business. I worked for AT&T, not Ford. I was a union man for 30 years. I fought for workers' rights. I walked my amount of picket lines. I honor picket lines. I won't shop at stores that are picketing. I believe in the workers' rights, which includes Darren McClary's. At the point where we were on the suspension, I was not going to bring his personal business up. And I guarantee you, whatever I said, you would want an explanation. No one would settle for what I was able to talk about. I would want it. Some people got it. I was shocked. Going through town, I had people said, Mr. Fetter, I know what you're doing. I appreciate that in you. I appreciate it. I said, well, thank you. Most people wanted an explanation, and I said, hang on. All I needed him to do was to give an interview. Pandora's box is open. If Darwin had not said anything, I would be taking your heat forever on not saying anything about his situation and how I came up with that decision. That was a cross I was willing to bear, as well as several of our colleagues. I will not cross that line, and I don't care if it's 100 people or 1,000 people. I don't believe in it. Mr. McClary has brought up many issues. I will not get into he said, she said, to where there's an argument over what he knew or what I knew, what I said or what he said. I'm gonna give you facts and figures of what's been going on behind closed doors. I submit to you that Darren McClary you see at this meeting is just a small sliver of what goes on in this community. Much like I think he can say the same about me. I also want to make sure people understand my decision. Someone said pray on it. I prayed on it. I thought about it. It was detrimental to me to have certain people get up all the time and talk about what he makes, where he lives, the car he drives. I was in favor of the 4 days. I don't care how many days a week someone works, just get the job done. And I've openly said that. I had no problem. I have no problem with his $99,000 or the car allowance. I think his benefit package was comparable to most communities of our size and was a little bit on the low side. So his compensation has nothing to do with my decision. It is or our decision. It is totally performance driven. Like Mr. Cordy, when I do the math, it is not what you hear. It is not acceptable. Likewise, on our appraisal, we give comments on sections and we can let him know what we like or dislike. I can tell you that Mr. McClary has a tendency to scream, yell, point fingers, and intimidate council at almost every chance he's had. Unless there's other people with us. He's very aggressive, to the point where we had a council member who left a meeting with tears in their eyes and could not continue. That's insubordination. Never in my years, ever, could you ever walk into your boss and let it fly and say the things that are said and still have your job. But let's say, by the good grace of God, he was cleansed. Let's go on. Balanced budget. As Mr. Cordy said, he has to. Every mayor or city manager has to. It's state law. We balanced it through layoffs. We balanced it through moving garbage off the budget. The lighting, which, by the way, folks, we're going to treat you like an ATM machine. We've got meetings scheduled. We're going to raise your prices again. You guys were right. You all showed up and said, I don't want you to move it off, because if you do, you're going to raise it every year. Our administration, what did they say? No, we're not. Guess what? Okay? So I guess that goes into planning. Our employees, under another city manager, negotiated a set of raises to their salaries. And the last raise was a 2.5% that they should have had a year or so ago. Our unions went to, most of our unions, because one didn't, went to the city manager and kept putting off getting their raise. They said, we cannot, in good conscience, take money from a community that we work for when you're hurting. They gave it up several times. They weren't approached for it. They approached us. Two of the unions carried it an extra step. They said, our new contract's coming up. We can't put it off anymore, so we're going to have to take it. And right at that point, we're talking about 3.5 millage, 4.2 millage. And I'm going, for the love of God, here we go. They said, we'll give it up. Go ahead and open our contract. Don't touch anything else. We'll give up our raise. Our city manager's comment to them was, I don't have time now, but I'll get back with you. So months go by. One of the unions approached them a second time. Their response wasn't much better. The other union said, I'm not going back to him twice. We've put it off. We came to him and said, keep our 2%, or 2.5. He didn't have time. Then the week the raise was going to hit, he sent a memo, a letter that I saw a copy of, to the unions saying, would you consider giving up this, basically giving up this raise? They were livid. A letter. They looked at me and said, you know, the fire department just agreed to a 20% copay in their health care, which I'll get into in a minute. We're going to hang on to. We have a work group who was ahead of all the others. Our city hall group, they started giving things up to us before the other unions did and continued all the way up to 6 months ago. I went to a meeting with them, and they're in tears. They're going, we haven't had a raise. We've given, we've given, we've given. And we're being treated like this. He won't talk. He won't show up for meetings. David, we're taking our raise because we know what's coming down the road. I said, I don't know what you can tell me. I can't do anything about it. When I've tried to talk to him about it, and folks, I'm not any quieter behind closed doors than I am here in the mic. I got more to lose here for people that don't like what I say. Okay? When I tried to talk to that man about it, he said, and I quote, if you can do a better job, you do it. Quote, if you can do a better job, you do it. I don't have much of a temper, but why I turned away, I felt silly. I turned away and walked out, and I thought of the things in the car I should have done and said, but I think I was better off not to. Let's talk concessions that he negotiated. He did. But it isn't what you think it is. Our unions laid down for us. Is there anything I can say? They fought very little. Yes, there's language we had changed. We changed when we're going to meet to negotiate so they all line up together. There were processes that he was successful in getting. We settled our employee contracts in less time than anybody in this city had ever seen in their lives. No one ever remembers settling as quickly as we did. With no backlash. We laid off and loved employees. Now, the unions that haven't settled yet that are coming up, they know we're going to want to mirror what the fire department did and what we put the court employees through. They're our only non-union group we have here. We normally give them what the other unions agree to, or we take from them what. Now, the court employees did not get a 2.5% raise, which is another thing. I was in a meeting with the judge and several of us, and the judge was lied to about who was getting raises, but it's, yes, he settled a contract. I don't agree with what is being said. This is the truth. And again, I'm not here to cause an argument. I'm just telling you what the truth is. The 3.5 mil, okay? As you know, there were a lot of questions. He asked for one amount, we ended up with another. That's part of business. I, at two occasions at this table, and this is one of the things people remembered, and I'm thankful for it. I asked him if he would have and hold citizen informational meetings. Oh, and of course, yeah, okay. 2 weeks go by, everyone's talking. Are we gonna hold citizen informational meetings, Mr. Darwin? Yep, okay. 2 weeks go by, actually we're having them every week, so I think another week went by. George Cordy says to him, Darwin, what's going on? Oh yeah, I'm having it. You know when we had him? After the absentee ballots were mailed. In this city, you can't do that. We have a huge population of people who vote absentee. Huge. You have to get out to these people. If you want to get elected to an office or get something passed, our seniors, our people on absentee are the most generous people I've ever met in my life. You people have said no to nothing yet. For the love of God, you've said yes to everything. God bless you. But we did not get our, now we, of course, we didn't need it. It overwhelmingly passed. The point here, ladies and gentlemen, is we can't get things done. We can't. The facade you see here is not the way the city's running. This council is divided. We've been divided since November on issues. I don't know how many times we've all voted in the same. It's not a division. We're going to get along and continue to get along. We're not turning the city back. The city's stepping back on its own because it doesn't understand. It doesn't understand because we have said nothing till now. I totally understand. Let me talk about our pension fund. A little over a year ago, our employees, and I'm going to refer into Plant Moran, it's our auditing company. Okay? Some of you might remember they had on their book where there was an issue of about $1.9 million. I asked the question, I was fairly new at the time, and I don't remember what was said, but I had the feeling that night I got blown off. I know a little bit more now. And our employees went from a city-run pension service, which Plant Moran calls, it was a single employer defined benefit pension plan that was administered by the city's employees retirement system. This plan covered substantially all employees of the city. They voted to go with what's called MERS. MERS is a Michigan Municipal Employee Retirement System. I believe at one time the state ran it. The benefit for us was, they were told, but I haven't seen it, that there would be about $60,000 a year in savings by us not handling it. Now, on the pension board, you had administrative people, administration, a professional money manager, council people, and I believe some union people. Or did they just attend meetings when they wanted? I'll stop short. Employees, okay? Which is probably union, because they're all union but the court. Now, I found out who our rep was for the pension fund. His name's John, real nice guy. And it's always been in the back of my mind and what's going on with this pension thing, because when I look at the information, we're not nearly close to being fully subsidized in our pension. And it seemed like we should be. So I made some phone calls, looked at some information and some notes people had. And there was an issue with property that was owned by the pension board when it was run by the city. It was hung on to for a while because it had lost value like our homes did. We had to transfer all the assets of the employee pension fund and transfer it over to the new MERS account. The city started transferring money, but not necessarily in an orderly fashion. Our auditing company talked to us about it. They talked about the issue with the property. And eventually, the board was advised to just sell it, take the loss, and send it over. During this time, the account with the city was supposed to be closed. Plant Moran was unable to accurately, in our last breakdown, and let me find their words, report what the end results were because of not sending the money over. So then I found out that not only did we not send the money over correctly, now keep in mind these are pensions, everybody looks at pensions, the state, everybody. During a 9-month period that I can figure out, we continually and wrongly kept depositing the employee's deduction for their pension in an old account. It should have been going directly to MERS. By this point, the account was established. There was money in it. Now, one thing we did not do in a timely fashion was send the necessary documentation to MERS so they knew who our employees were. MERS started calling City Hall saying, if you need help, we'll come help you. Do you want us to come out? They kept being rebuffed. Finally, it got to the point they couldn't do anything else. And they said, we are now going to start levying fines if you do not comply by a certain date. At that point, within 6 days of that, we transferred everything over. We stopped misapplying the employees' pension money that's coming out of their check, and it went to MERS. The other issue is with it, from what I can tell, most people involved, including people that were with Mr. McLarty when this was being discussed, The interest rate on the old account was very low. The interest rate that MERS was paying was competitive. And I word it this way because I've gotten different figures from different people. And in a memo I have from Darwin, he even somewhat admits it depends on the calculation. But we basically had an error of $1.9 million in the account that was being played with. If you take the difference in the interest rate that we lost by not being with MERS, it comes to tens of thousands of dollars. My opinion is, from what I can feel, it's around $91,000. Our average retiree makes a little over $20,000 a year. That money would have funded four retirees 12 months. Now, we're still looking into these issues because we have to look at, are there extra payments being made? When were the payments made? I'm not done with it. Nor am I divulging everything I know at this point. I'm saying it was an issue. It was an issue our administration was aware of. It's an issue our administrative blew off by saying they're too busy. And it wasn't being taken serious until it came to the point where, in my opinion, nothing could be covered up because we were going to get fined. All of a sudden, we found the people, we got the money transferred, and they wanted it to go away. I haven't listed everything. I'm just going through some big things. I want to give you all a reason. I know there's going to be people out there when I'm done that I still won't believe anything, and that's okay. I can't do anything for you. I was out walking my dog today, and someone came up, and he said, Dave, he says, there's an old saying. I had to write it down. My mind is made up, so don't confuse me with the facts. So if you're that person, then that's fine. Let me talk about an issue where I talk about intimidation. Mr. Kerwin, there were some things going on here that some of us were not happy with. We found some council members weren't interested. Some were. Mr. Kerwin at one point, and I know some people thought it was funny, but there was a purpose to his madness. He asked to see the employment records of our department heads. And there was pushback, big pushback, and it was ignored, as usual. The following week, did anybody catch it? He brought it up again. Pushback and ignored. Our city manager at the time sought legal advice from our attorney, who basically said, council has the right minus certain information. And I remember it was health care information, social security number, address. Things of that sort. Mr. Kerwin publicly said, I don't care about any of that. I want to see their work file. How have they performed? How are they rated? Keep in mind, there was a purpose. There were things going on, and we're going, oh my God, how is this happening? What is going on here? I've never experienced this. So we were under the impression he should get it. Mr. Kerwin then said, because it was offered, well, we're going to copy everything and give it to you. He says, no, I'll come in and read it. Don't do that. I'll come in with a thermos of coffee, I'll sit in the conference room, and I'll go through it. I don't want copies of anything. They said no. Then he was told he had to fill out an FOI request, Freedom of Information. And he shook his head and says, I don't understand why, but it's one more pushback, one more thing I have to do, one more reason we cannot get along with City Hall. He filled it out. Well, he got the information. It was quite eye-opening. I saw it as well. Some of our department heads, Anyway, guess what came in the mail to him after all that, after over a month of waiting, after all the requests, all the hoops, all right, to try to judge it? He got a bill for, guess what? Filling out a Freedom of Information Act form. The city, on city letterhead, billed him $602.54 for $392 for the pages, 1 hour for something, 7.3 hours for something else. Now, this is a council member who's entitled to it. We had a legal opinion we're entitled to it. This is just an example, a documented example. Now, based on that, his request went from that to timesheets. Don't you know they billed him for that too? His total billings were $703.22. And this is a city manager that works well with other people. This is not innuendo. This is not my opinion. This happened in front of everybody. But I can understand where you would not put two and two together. Because again, the play happens behind the curtains a lot of the time instead of in front. Let's talk about a secret letter of agreement he made with a resident with a dilapidated house in the city. He entered into an actual written agreement with a citizen in the town that had a dilapidated house. He bought it at an auction. Really bad shape. And in the agreement, he stated what he'd like to see as far as a timeline of getting things done. He signed it and the citizen signed it. And it had a drop dead date on it. While he was out of town, I was dealing with one of the department heads and I came across the letter. He was quite surprised I had it. So I got the feeling he really didn't mean for us to see it, because he cannot, on his own, enter into anything. It has to come to us. He's the employee. We're the representatives of the city. Then when we sought legal advice on it, it was unenforceable because we did not authorize it. By the way, that house still isn't done. We're still fighting with them, and it's going to be a year. We also have, talking about ignoring things, George brought his up. Does anybody remember me saying about 22 times, what about, what could we say, farming out payroll during the budget process? You have to. I talk about it every time. How can we put a budget together? You're talking about a balanced budget. I'm saying he has to. If I was city manager, I'd have to. Now, was there talent involved? Sure. Did he work hard on it? Sure. Part of the budget making process is for us to take the time and look at everything that is there. Part of that big process was Plymouth Township's done it, Livonia's done it, and I think Farmington. They farmed out their payroll. We have a person here who does it. We pay that person their wages and health care. What would it be if we farmed it out? What would that cost be? Could we save money? Could we save on health care? Don't know. Still don't. I brought it up in November. I brought it up in March. I brought it up April 30th. On April 30th, Ms. Bettis replied to me, oh, it's at a company, and she named the company. We're having a study done. I didn't look at my calendar, but anybody know what month and day it is today? Don't have anything. I not only brought it up, George has brought it up. Jody's brought it up. I'll say Jim too, but I don't know about him. It's, again, these are small examples, but we all have these stories. I heard him in an interview say, well, I heard the interviewer say, well, that's a shame. You're down on personnel, aren't you? It's got to be hard, or something along that line. Of course, he said yes. He went from two people to one. We got rid of 11 people. Our fire department cannot go in a burning house unless you're in it. They can't. Our police department's barely covering calls. Our DPW's way down, and our city hall got gutted. We barely have enough. We're open 4 days a week now, and we're open during lunches. We have one person covering the whole city hall for an hour during lunch. These women are going crazy, and they're doing it. They're still smiling and greeting people when they come in. And you get somebody on a commercial whine because they lost one person? It's an excuse. I can't take excuses. I want results. If I don't give you a result, then don't vote for me. If I do, then vote for me. Here we go again. Let me give you another example. On this program, I heard the interview. The person doing the interview said something about Fetters talking about the health care issue. Can you shed some light on it? And it's always Fetter, but I understand. Someone's got to be named. Why not me? And Darwin's explanation was, well, you know, we went with that new 20% copay. We got that negotiated. And I'm paraphrasing. I'm trying to remember. But, yeah, we got that negotiated. And I know he's upset because we did not let the employees know till July 31st. But I sent an email to the courts. I told them. They knew they had to start paying it. They knew before that date. Well, I saw the email he sent. I have a copy of it, but I won't get into that. The employees knew. He's right. It stops there. Because the interviewer said to him, Darwin, why did they know so late? And he said, well, I asked in time, but it took so long. I have to wait for them to get back to me. I had no choice. The interviewer says, oh, okay, I understand. I'm going crazy. I'm going, oh, my God, ask the next question. Think. Let me give you the facts on this one, too. The council adopted a resolution electing to require city employees to begin contributing 20% toward health care costs pursuant to Michigan Public Act 152. And we're supposed to get the payment set up. On April 16th, we adopted an employee compensation plan as the third and final requirement for our state revenue sharing. Again, it's partially dictated by the state. But there were options. They didn't have to go with that. There could have been another one, right? So the firefighters accepted the contract. We voted it in. We passed state scrutiny all by the middle of April, of the 1st of May. We went May, June, oh, and by the way, in the firefighters' contract, it stipulates it talks about their paying 20%, whether they do pre-tax, post-tax, and whether they opt in or out. I don't know if anyone's had to do what I did. You have to choose. You have the option of choosing your health care plan. How do you want it deducted? All that sort of stuff. It wasn't quite as intense yet, but it'll get there. All right. His response was, I couldn't do anything about it. So what did I do? Had the rep called. When did we contact you to ask for the employee's health care? Now keep in mind, and I have a copy of it. I can't show you because it's got people's personal information on it. It gives their name, the amount every 2 weeks, the health care plan, all that stuff. And there's pages they have to fill out. It's a little mini booklet. And it goes to the health care plan. Okay? I had one lady who said, she would never have chosen to keep it because her husband has insurance. She had ours because it was free. I don't blame her. Now that she has to pay, she doesn't want it. Guess what? She's got it. You know what our rep told us that handles our insurances? Which is the only way we can get it changed is to go through him, right? We hire someone to take care of it. We don't call Blue Cross. We contacted him on July 24th. We had to have, per the firefighters' contract, everything to them by July 1st. Our firefighters' union had spoken with their union and were getting ready to file against us. Okay? We called on July 24th. The letter that was sent to the employees telling them how much they're going to have out of their check, but giving them no options, was dated July 31st, which I think was a Wednesday. We didn't walk across the hall here to give it to the employees. Wouldn't you think? Darwin's office is right there. The court's right here. Wouldn't you think we'd take the stack of all the employees in the court, walk across the aisle, knock on the door, and say, here, get back with me? Cheryl would, our benefits coordinator, would be here to answer questions. None of that was done. A letter was mailed to their homes, not given to them here. Now, I haven't heard if our employees were able. Oh, and by the way, we had to approve it all, and we didn't get the packet to August 23rd. I've got the packet with the date. I'm not picking on the man. I'm telling you what it is. Lighting assessment. I touched on it. Remember last year? Remember the crowds? Remember we're going to balance the budget with it, which helped. It did. What did we say? No, it's not going to go up. As a matter of fact, at one point, do some of you remember, it's going down 42 cents? Guess what? We haven't had the meetings yet. From what I can tell, we've had no rate increases, guys. Our bill hasn't gone up. Yours is. $4 to $7. Wait to the meetings. You were right. We started a new fund. We came in low, and we're going high. I will not be supporting, as I did before, a lighting assessment. We need to start turning off lights then. Pick quadrants and shut the things down for 3 days a week. There's got to be a switch somewhere, wouldn't you think? But we'll address that. My point is that's poor planning. We should not be coming back to you within 7 and 8 months of passing a special assessment where we swore we knew what we were doing, but voila, guess what? It's got to go up. We were wrong. This is administration. People can say what they want and they can threaten. I understand the emotion. I understand there's people out there that will say I still haven't said enough. I think I've said too much. It was more than I wanted to say. This, I was ready to throw myself on the sword and keep my mouth shut. Okay.
No, wait, no comments.
You want my $100 back?
I don't want your $100.
I demonstrated
no,
my.
No more talking unless you're at the podium.
Why are you throwing him out?
Sir, it's your last warning.
I've demonstrated my willingness to do that by, as you quote me, you have no right to know. If nothing had been said, I would still say, maybe I worded it wrong, but you have no right to know. This is his business. He has, if he had a question on why we...
Sir, this is your last warning.
If
sir,
we had a question...
That's your first and last warning.
If he had any kind of questions about anything, he could have called me or anything else at any time. That's not an issue. I don't have an issue with it. My phone never rang. So, I wanted to give you just some information that I and others up here have not been happy with. We still are not happy with some of the information we have. And once we get some new forms filed, we will be looking into some other issues a little more in depth. We want to make sure everything is the way it should be and proper. Not that it isn't now, but we just want to make sure. And I will be voting to terminate his contract. Thank you.
Anybody else? Ms. Squires?
Okay. Well, it's a darn shame that I couldn't get at that information.
Pay attention.
I do pay attention.
Mr. Fetter?
No.
Mr. Squires has the floor.
Okay.
He must be quiet. He's got to be respectful
to
his peers.
I made a comment.
Throw him out.
Last warning for everybody out there. Next person, I'm going to throw him out.
Throw me out, man. Yeah, I know. That's what I thought.
Mr. Bowers, you're going to have to leave.
Yes, sir. Not a problem.
That's everybody's final warning. The next person that pops off, they're gone. Mr. Fetter, please respect Ms. Squires when she has the floor. Nobody interrupted you when you talked. Ms. Squires, go ahead.
Thank you. No, it would have been nice if I had been told all of this information. It was all kept a secret from me also. Also, some of Mr. Fetter's facts were not completely true. He doesn't have all the facts. I'm not going to go into details, it makes no difference, but I, like you people out there, am a resident of this city, and as a resident, I will not support getting rid of Mr. McCleary. Thank you.
Okay, this situation is unfortunate. Communication goes two ways, not just one way. I am in agreement with Mrs. Squires. There's things that were said tonight that I didn't know about either. If they were really important, I would think that other council members would say, hey, let's go out for coffee. Let's talk about this. Let me show you what I have. I did not get that information either. When it comes to some of the facts, one of the ones that bothered me the most was Mr. McCleary only lost one person. Mr. McCleary only had one person. That person was Margot. Margot answered the phone and took care of a lot of things in the city manager's office. So when a person loses their only person, what happened was the HR person started doing double duty, and that is the truth. Now, when a person does double duty, you know that you can't focus on any one thing. So, such as when, well, why couldn't they just walk it across the hall? Well, sometimes the telephone is ringing off the hook. There are people at the desk. It's hard to be able to just simply walk across the hall. I get the idea behind it, but sometimes it's not just as simple as what it sounded like as it was being said. Part of our problem in council, when Mr. Fetter said that something didn't come to us, that was done at the end of July, didn't come to us until the end of August, well, that's because we only have two meetings a month, the second and the fourth Mondays. That's a problem for council because there's a lot of things going on. Two meetings a month does not give us the opportunity to do things in a timely fashion. And maybe we would have had something earlier had we had an additional meeting or the meeting would have been sooner. That is a problem, and I will say that. But the fact that it came two meetings later, that gave one meeting to get all of the stuff together, and then the following meeting. Some of the information that was said, that is one side of the story. when I questioned on some of the information, and I questioned other people, not just Mr. McClary, but other people, I got more information than that, which means that what happens is if you hear part of a story, if you're not in the middle of the story happening, maybe you're not getting all of the information. So some things that are important to one council person, what they're hearing, maybe there's some information left out, maybe not on purpose, but each person knows that something's important to them. They make sure that gets out to the people. I know when it comes to the so-called secret agreement between a resident, I know that building department has put together agreements like that on a regular basis probably since I've been on council. I don't look at that as a secret agreement. And the fact that council wasn't given that agreement, we're not given a lot of building department stuff. That's not something that we're involved in the middle of, unless we're asking for something on it, or unless it comes to council for us to vote. We are policies and procedures. We pass budgets, we pass big amounts of money, but the day-to-day operations, we're not in the middle of all of that. The other thing that I noticed is many of these things are personnel issues all the way through, having to do with personnel things. If a union wants to grieve something, by all means, grieve the item. Let it come before and let it go to a grievance. That's the right thing to do. I would never say that it's not. They need to do what they need to do. The fact that it didn't come to a grievance, it means that they were able to settle it in some other fashion that worked for both of them at the time. Things like this happen. The things that I'm most upset about is the fact that as you look at a job, and I know as a former administrator, sometimes sitting in the seat, you'd like to think that you get all of your work done within the 8 hours or 10 hours or whatever. With phones ringing, with people to talk to, with meetings to go to, and everything else that happens in the course of a day, sometimes some of the things that one person thinks should be a priority isn't necessarily the priority of the other person. That's where the good communication comes in. That's where other people on council understanding some of the facts that other people know and convincing us that this is a higher priority, whereas all of council would be on the person having to do with this should be a high priority, let's get this done now. Because I know that one of the items in here that Mr. Fetter talked about, he did tell me about it, and he did convince me that it was a high priority, and I did get involved. And it may not have gotten done in the timely fashion that we wish it would have, but it did get done faster, because it got moved to be a timely priority. In fact, I remember one of the people going in saying, okay, I thought this, and this were priorities. Now, tell me which priority you want me to make the priority. Because there were so many things happening all at the same time. Things like that happen. I understand that. But I go back to good communication and documenting, and that means council has to document. And council has to present it so that if we knew all of these items that were bothering some of the other people, we could get on it, we could get down to the bottom, and we could make some things happen or understand why they're not happening as fast as they were. And as far as the payroll goals, I happen to know that there was a meeting last Monday and two people from City Hall went out to the meeting. I believe it was two, it might have only been one though. But they went out to see how payroll was done in another community. It is happening. Yes, it's slower than a couple council members would like, but it's happening amid all the other things. And these aren't all Mr. McClary's jobs. We have three elections going on this year. There's a lot of time that's put into three elections. So sometimes department heads are juggling things and you can't clone yourself and be everywhere all at the same time. I do not agree with the way this was done. I do not agree with the procedure that this has taken. And I still agree that better communication and documentation would have solved the problem. And whether we let them go or not, based on the documentation and better communication, I could have gone along with that. But without it, I have a problem with it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Lynch. Council, it's a major decision you're making tonight. This isn't voting to purchase a new DPS vehicle. This is to terminate a man's livelihood. A lot of this stuff I've heard tonight for the first time. Mr. Federer, I'm not saying what you've stated is not truthful, but you evidently got it from a source, and we just heard one side of it, and maybe there's answers that we don't know for that reason. But it was never brought up to me before tonight. I know one time at the council meeting, you were asking Mr. McCleary about some information, I think it was on the budget from the fire department, and he hadn't even received it yet. So you evidently get information direct from the fire department sometimes before Mr. McCleary even seen it. And we can go back and find that on a tape too. So, you know, here's the other thing I want to bring up. All seven of us that sit at this table all have jobs. We're all part-time council people. The department heads, police chief, fire chief, clerk, DPS, are full-time employees. I find it ironic not one department head has ever approached me and said, hey, we got to do something about the city manager. We got to get rid of him. He's no good. They work with him day to day, every day, several hours a week. We're all part-time. No disrespect, but we got a couple council members that don't even have 1 year under their belt yet. And they already know enough to terminate a city manager, again, when not one department head or employee has come up to me and said the city manager needs to go. To me, that speaks volumes. I don't like the way it was done. I was notified, me and the wife were parking in downtown Detroit getting ready to walk into the Tiger game. My phone rang and it was the city attorney telling me that on Monday, this was on a Friday night, that some of the council members are gonna make a motion to suspend the city manager. Had the city attorney not called me on Friday night, had I not answered my phone as I was going into the Tiger game, I would have been caught here at the table. To me, it's very unprofessional. Some other comments about yelling in the back room. I was there, my recollection, I seen one council member yell at the city manager. The city manager yelled back, if you dish it out, you gotta be able to take it. The council member stormed out. Some people can't take corrective criticism. Whatever, I mean, different ways to look at it. But he was fired up just as a council member was. But when he answered back, they ran out of the room. Again, I work at Ford Motor Company in management. We coach and counsel our employees. If you got a problem, you got to walk them up a ladder. You got to put a letter in their file. You got to call them in and talk to them. Say, I want to see improvement in this area. You just don't arbitrarily terminate you. Lack of confidence. And then 2 weeks later, come with a laundry list. First time I've heard a lot of this. Doesn't mean it's all true. There could be answers for a lot of this information that was presented tonight. I don't support this. Talk about how lean we are, especially in our police department. Now we have a part-time police chief and a part-time city manager. We're even thinner. We're on a balanced budget. City manager conducted several town hall meetings, informed the people. He's blamed for property issues. He sends the ordinance officer out. The ordinance officer writes the ticket. Now it's in the court's hands. The court dates 5-6 weeks down the road. Then they come 2 weeks to the next council meeting and yell at the city manager because nothing's being done. He can't do nothing at that point. It's in the court process. The court date is down the road. You can keep coming to the next council meeting, and yell at him because these properties issues aren't getting taken care of. Once we issue tickets, it's in the court's hands. But you want to blame him for that? Go ahead and blame him for that. Just had a resident tonight say that she had a rat problem at Harrison and Maplewood, and Mr. McCleary showed up. That's just another example of how he is out in the community. Again, I'm disappointed in council. I wish you would think real hard before you vote. As a lot of residents have said tonight, I'm in agreement with them. And I do not support the termination of the city manager. Any other comments from council?
Just one thing.
Mr. Kerwin.
So the public does know, the way this was done and the way this was handled is the way our city attorney advised us to handle this. So that's what exactly what was done. I do believe in complete open and transparency in government. There's sometimes, though, you elected all of us that we can't tell you everything, not at that point. There are personal matters that people don't need to know about. Eventually you're going to know about them, I'm sure, like everybody else. But I am very, very happy that all of you come out to speak your opinion. And that's your absolute right to vote the way you think. And like Mr. Fetter said, if you think he's doing it right, or I'm doing it right, or anybody else, vote for us. And if you don't, absolutely do not. But some of us are trying to do the right thing for our citizens, for our taxpayers. So that's all I have here. Thank you.
Any comments from council? Ms. Bettis, take the vote, please.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge?
Aye.
Councilmember Fetter?
Aye.
Councilmember Lynch?
No.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Nay.
Mayor Walker?
Nay.
Where's the Lord?
Mr. Wallace, you're out.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to be away from you. Stay away.
Okay, we will move on to item 9, the consent agenda.
Mayor, move for the approval of the consent agenda, item 9A, 1 through 4.
Hang on a minute. Mr. York, we're going to recess for a few minutes, let people clear out.
Allison, do you need me to remake that motion?
Okay, council is back in session.
Yes, if you make one.
The next item on our agenda is item 9, the consent agenda.
Mayor?
Ms. Lynch?
I move for approval of the consent agenda, items 9A, 1 through 4.
Support.
Support from Councilmember Dodge. Discussion from council, from the general public. Ms. Bettis?
Councilmember Lynch?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge?
Aye.
Councilmember Fetter?
Aye.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Aye.
Mayor Walker?
Aye. We will move into our study session. Item 1, special land use for a restaurant at 32293 Ford Road. Council, this is the former Dario's. They want to make it into a Chinese restaurant. If we take no action, then it will go through as the Planning Commission has recommended.
Or we could approve it and then go into tomorrow, right?
Is that? If we take no action, if
20 days or something.
20 days. If we approve
right.
it would be right now, though, wouldn't it?
I don't know.
If council.
Ms. Trashman? Would it speed things up if we approved it now, or just if we take no action? That's the question.
I reviewed before.
I think it doesn't matter. It's 20 days.
I think it's 20 days regardless. Yeah.
20 days regardless.
I actually do think it's also 20 days.
We went through this with the Kroger gas station regardless.
So, council, you want to move that to C?
Yes.
Sure.
To C.
Okay, item 2, another special land use for massage therapist at 300-32 Ford Road. Same thing applies here. They had a public hearing.
But this one, I think we need to approve in the commission, the conditions. There is on the last page conditions.
Okay, you want to move it to C though?
Yeah.
Okay. Item three, change order number two, Harrison Avenue reconstruction and water main replacement. We have Ryan from Hennessy. You want to come up and explain to us what item three is all about?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. On the Harrison Avenue reconstruction project, as I mentioned a few times prior, we have a water meter pit that's located down towards Marquette Avenue. Mm-hmm. With the widening of that road, approximately 4 feet of that road is going to be over top of the meter pit, and therefore the council did approve in late July to proceed with constructing a reinforced grade beam over that pit. In order to get this project under construction this season, we bid it out as a worst case scenario in that we had to reconstruct the entire pit, and that after the bid we would go back to the contractor for a change order and a deduction and doing the reinforced grade beam. That's due to the time needed for DWSD to approve that work. The bid came in at $57,000 to reconstruct the pit. Soon after that bid, we got the approval from the engineering department at DWSD to do the reinforced grade beam. The contractor came back to us with a price of $24,500 to do that work, which was a deduct of $32,500, which council approved about a month ago or so. Since that time, DWSD and our office have met on the site to go over the project and also proposed that reinforced grade beam was the relocation of the access hatch. We needed to reconstruct the access hatch with the reinforced grade beam being installed. We were going to relocate that so that it was outside of the roadway. Because of the current location, it would be within the southbound parking lane. However, with all the equipment and piping that's within that meter pit, what the proposed location still allows man access into the pit. However, if they were to remove any equipment, basically bringing that up, it would be over the bypass piping. So they did not want to have that access hatch over any of the piping or equipment. The only place that's doable, unfortunately, is within the roadway, which again brings a safety issue. We don't want to have that hatch in the roadway. So therefore, the only option that we have in order to get it out of the roadway and not have it over any piping equipment is to extend that pit by constructing a 4-foot by 4-foot area off the southwest corner of that pit. That gets it outside of the roadway. There's no conflict with any other utilities there, and it won't be over any of the piping and equipment. That work is gonna cost $18,115. So in front of you tonight is a change order for an increase of $18,115. I believe attached with the change order you received was an invoice from the contractor that had a total cost of $42,000 and some dollars. That's the total cost of the entire work that's involved with the meter pit. So that's the $24,500 for the reinforced grade beam work, plus the $18,115 change order presented to you tonight totals the $42,600 and some dollars.
Any questions for Ryan?
Mayor.
Ms. Dodd.
Okay. DWSD, they approved the reinforced grade beam. That's what you brought to us. That's what brought the deduction. We were all happy about it because they actually got in touch with you. DWSD is the one requesting that us move the access hatch.
That's correct. Their meter operations division, yes.
Are they going to chip in any money for it? Why didn't they request this at the very beginning when we told them this is what we're doing?
I would agree with you on that.
I wouldn't put it on your engineering firm. You were saying that you, because in all the documentation, it's DWSD.
I would agree with you on that. Fortunately, with DWSD, that's, in a lot of cases, that's kind of how they operate.
What if we had already had the roadway done and everything done? And then they come back.
At that point, I mean, it'd be kind of tough to That's kind of why we had an on-site meeting before we started, to make sure that, all right, everybody's on the same page. We want to make sure that we're going to do this right and get it done before we do this road. So fortunately, we did have that on-site meeting, but if that came up after the fact, I think, you know, we'd have to prove our case. You know, they had sufficient time to review these plans, and, you know, now the road's constructed, and there's not much you can do at that point.
So how far are we in the process by this pit?
We have not started any work on that pit yet. We were going to start working on that pit, and then this hatch, access hatch issue came up. At this point, it has not delayed the project, but it could if we don't get anything going on this.
Mr. Kern, what's the odds of them having to go into that pit? It wouldn't be our, I guess our crews are in the pit often, but with their crews to add and remove piping or not minimal.
It may never happen, but yeah, it's very minimal, yes.
What's your honest opinion? I mean, if we're gonna have to do this, say, one time in the next 10 years, I mean, flesh and air works pretty good.
Pardon?
Flesh and air works pretty good, right. So cheaper, you know.
Right, right.
And where would that be? That would be up in the farm area? The access pole panel?
It would be within the green belt.
It would be?
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
I don't know. Is this absolutely necessary, or?
It probably is the best location for it, just so that it is outside of the, so that there are no conflicts with any of the equipment in the pit. It is a DWSD-owned pit. Unfortunately, in the contract with DWSD, it does state that any modifications that are required for that pit are borne by the city.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
And we're still, we had a price decrease of $32,500, so we still are under a decrease.
That's correct.
Even with the $18,000.
That's correct, by about $15,000.
Overall, you're saying for the overall,
yes.
I mean, we had a lump sum that we had put in to the bid to begin with.
Correct.
And they've come back. I'm kind of like Councilor Dodge here, Ricard, you know, if DWSD was out there, but again, I've worked in years past with cities of Detroit and other cities, and I know how sometimes that can be. This is painful to swallow, but I think we have to do it. It's unfortunate.
Mm-hmm. So it's a different department within DWSD. Now, is it going to go to another department and then come out and give us another
whammy?
Start at that end.
No, there would be no other departments involved with the meter pit. It would just be engineering and the meter operations divisions.
It's unfortunate.
See agenda.
Thank you.
Okay, the next one is Sandland Crate. I'm sure you guys want that to go to C, right?
Agenda.
Yes, sir.
And then item five, no action tonight, Chief?
That's correct, Your Honor. It's simply remains on the B agenda, so okay. We're all aware that it's ongoing.
We will move to the C agenda, C1.
Mayor?
Ms. Lynch?
I move that council concur with Amy Neary, Planning and Zoning Administrator, and approve the 12-010 special land use section 154.417 for a restaurant at 32293 Ford Road.
Support from Council Member Squire. Discussion from council. From the general public. Ms. Bettis.
Councilmember Lynch?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge?
Aye.
Councilmember Fettig?
Aye.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Mayor Walker?
Aye. Item C2, special land use.
I don't know, it's the same thing?
No, it's a different one.
No, I mean, it's the same deal with 40 days? Or? Yeah. What do you think, Mayor? Do you want to take that into consideration or just take no action?
Take the motion if you want. It's up to you.
I'd say we just take no action.
Well, we've already moved it to C.
We've already moved it to C.
So I'd like to make a motion, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Fetter?
I can make a motion to make 12-004 special land use, section 154.417, for a regulated use, massage therapy at 30032 Ford Road, section 154.163.
Support from Mr. Kerwin. Discussion from council.
Mayor, if I can make a friendly amendment, that it include the planning commission's recommendations.
Is that okay with that?
I agree.
Okay. Discussion from council. From the general public. Ms. Bettis.
Councilmember Fetter.
Aye.
Councilmember Kerwin.
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge.
Aye.
Councilmember Lynch.
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy.
Aye.
Councilmember Squires.
Aye.
Mayor Walker.
Aye. Item C3, change order.
Mayor.
Ms. Dodge.
I move to approve change order number 2 to increase the cost of the Harrison Avenue reconstruction and water main project improvement by $18,115 and authorize the city manager to sign all necessary documents. The new contract amount for CI contracting of Brighton, Michigan is $1.3 million. Let's just shorten it that way.
Support.
Support from Councilmember Cordy. Discussion from council. From the general public. Mr. Chico.
Is this? My question is that, you know, having been done over 10 years in the underground world and structures and all that neat stuff years ago, is this just to move it in the road right out in the row where it's out of traffic?
The hatch and
there's no technical reason to go in that manhole and say we need to make it bigger or anything like that. This is just to get an access hatch in the grass
and the piping.
That's insane. I don't think there's a spec that says all of the Detroit water meter pits have to be in a green belt. Okay, then they would be pulling every one of them out every city. You know, I mean, I work Detroit Edison. You know how many thousands, 20,000, over 20,000 manholes in the ground. We don't move manholes just to make them easily accessible. We shut down the road and we go in there. That's all this is a comfort level for the Detroit water. Now, you can say that we have to go by their specs, okay? Where's the spec that says it's gotta be in the green belt? That's what I'm asking.
It's also to take it away from all the underground, the pipes and...
Mr. Kerwin?
I was just going to say, from the engineers, what the City of Detroit Water Department is telling our engineer, that they need, not only would they like it out of the road, but they need it big enough so they have access if they do need to add or remove piping from the pit.
Okay.
Can I
ask another question?
Sure, come on.
What was wrong with the size when you were checking it before? It's still confined space, you gotta harness up, you gotta do all that stuff.
Come up to the podium, Mr. Chico.
So, my question is that I feel that I didn't get a good answer from this gentleman because he answered the question properly to make you say, okay, we have to follow Detroit Water spec. What's the spec? That's what I wanna know. Is the spec that you can't access in the road? You've gotta access it from a green belt? Then, okay, let's see the spec. I just don't think there's a spec out there. $18,000, you know, $20,000. You started the question, and you got me and hooked on it, and Jody started it. It's your fault. No, but I've done too many structures in the road right away. This is not a good reason to actually make the structure bigger so right. You can go in the green belt and get in it.
Yeah. We'll bring them back up.
This was an issue that came up in front of the city a while back. There is no specific spec with DWSD as far as that structure being in the roadway. There are many times where there is no choice. It has to be within the roadway. I think there was a consensus several months ago when this topic first came up that it was a safety issue with not only DWSD but with city DPS employees entering and exiting that structure.
That's why
there's no specific specification through DWSD as far as... that it cannot be within the roadway.
I thought that's why we put the beam over it.
Pardon?
For the safety issue.
Pardon?
I thought that's why we added the beam for the safety issue. I didn't know we were moving the hatch.
We needed to, by placing that reinforced grade beam, also we needed to reconstruct the access hatch as part of the addition of the reinforced grade beam.
Mayor?
Ms. Lynch?
What would happen if council did not give approval for this? What's the possible ramifications?
Could I interrupt one second, Ms. Lynch? Mm-hmm. If we could ask Mr. Barnes just one question. I know the city of Detroit goes in there occasionally. How often do our crews, are they in there? They're in there relatively often, aren't they? Not? I mean, if it's safety for our people, that's a must. So.
Right.
Our people are in there when we have to do maintenance, preventing maintenance on PRVs. I'm not sure if we're in it more or less, to be honest, because they have to do preventing maintenance on meters and calibration on meters. So it's probably, I don't know, about equal.
What, once every 10 years?
Well, I was
that's what we're hearing.
Our people were in the hole, actually.
In the meter pits, we do preventing maintenance on the PRVs.
Oh, 2-3 times a year at least, right?
And then the Detroit does preventing maintenance on the meters, mm-hmm. about the same
that's
amount.
Well, they're in about the same.
Yeah.
Okay. So they're in it.
Just to answer Ms. Lynch's question.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
If we were, DWSD would not, if we were to put it in the roadway, they could not say, we cannot put it in the roadway. It was just based on safety issues is why we were looking to relocate it. So it, mm-hmm. it could. DWSD could approve it within the roadway. And there was also a question on the size of the hatch. They do require a hatch that's 4 foot by 5 foot.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Mayor. I still don't understand why this wasn't brought up before. And we're going down that slick road of changes we were afraid of with this. We were told we had to reinforce the top mm-hmm. and some of the other things. We approved it. And we said at the time, I think you did, you were right on it. Mm-hmm. Can it be here? Yes. Does it? No. And now all of a sudden, we need to move it and it's another $18,000. I think Mr. Chico ran brought up a very good point. I don't want to do it. I mean, I don't know how long maintenance costs, but shut the road down. Shut it down, put up cones, put up a truck.
Mr. Fetter, I think if our engineer, believe me, I would be the first one to blame them. But I don't really think it's their problem. They had it all done, and then DWSD came back, and then they said, after they'd already gone to them, then they came up with this. So it's not our fault or their fault, you know.
But if we don't do it, DWSD, there's no ramifications with them. If we don't do it, there's no ramifications with DWSD.
Like
right.
Mr. Buckner?
You know, I questioned this when it came up before, and you answered me on this, that they were held at 10% override, correct? And part of this is going for the towards the override, right?
No, not yet.
This has nothing to do?
No.
Okay.
It's still under.
My other point is, if it's been safe all these years, and that pit, from what I've researched on it, what we have is OSHA safe with the equipment in there. Now, I'm being facetious when I say this. I'm not worried about Detroit. Worried about Garden City. And what's best for us, and spend the less money, but get what's best for us. I say we don't need it.
Mayor?
Yes, sir?
I move to withdraw my motion.
Okay. I will as well.
Okay. Motion has no support.
There is no motion.
There is no motion.
Oh, okay. All right. Then it stays as it is. Item 4.
Mayor.
Mr. Kerwin.
To adopt the attached resolution for the 2012 Downtown Garden City Sandland Parade, November 24, 2012.
Support.
Support from Ms. Squires. Discussion from council. I believe this will be our 52nd annual. 52nd Annual Santa Land Parade. Any discussion from the general public? Mr. Buckner?
As some of you know, I'm on the promotional committee of the DDA. And I talk to a lot of the businesses because, I guess, being the manager, they feel like I can have more of a rapport with them. And I'm going to tell you this, and I'm being honest, I'm not trying to throw those. Right. The biggest feedback I get from business owners, and I'm talking in the business district, they do not hear from us. When I say from us, I'm talking about DDA, City Hall, Mayor, Council. I think we need to turn it around. Really turn it around. If you want Garden City to grow, you really need to get the business involved. I don't see it. If I was a business owner and I would come to them, come to myself like I have been, I would tell them to go to Hades. Okay? The only time you come to see me is when you have your hand out. Now, Mayor, I'm not picking on you, and this is the only time I'm going to call you Mayor. When was the last time that you took a day and visit these businesses? Went in, besides Albert's and others, but went in and talked to them. There's quite a few of them have told me they've never seen you, and I can give you some great ideas how to do it, but that's something you have to do on your own. Council people, how many of you have done it? Go into these businesses. It doesn't mean you have to buy off of them. Just walk in, say hi. That's how you build a rapport. That's how you get the businesses behind you to do what you want to do in this community and to grow and to get it back to where it was 20 years ago when I came here, when it was vibrant, when it was exciting. Excuse me, because I'm dealing with a sore throat. I don't see that here anymore. I want the city to get back where it was. That's why I'm getting involved. I'm not here to be a pain in your side. I'm here to try to wake you up. I want to be the thorn in your flesh to get you to move and do something. And I'll work with you. You do it, I'm behind you. But do it the right way. If you're not, I'm going to call you out on it.
Anybody else? Ms. Bettis?
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodd?
Aye.
Councilmember Feta?
Aye.
Councilmember Lynch?
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Mayor Walker?
Aye. We will move on to public comments that were not on the agenda tonight. There's a 5-minute time limit. Mr. Chico? Again, these are for items that were not on the agenda.
Good evening, Council. I had some notes here. I think I'd made a comment earlier. You guys need to get back as a team. You're going to make me run for council. This time I'll try. Harder. I guess my first statement is that we've all watched the news this week, in the last few weeks. Hats off to the city police department. The work that they've done in our city is just awesome. I'm ready for a millage to help them out. True facts. Only kidding. But Chief, you got a great workforce, and I really do appreciate our city, as well as city workers that helped out with caging the last bank robber. Pretty gutsy. Let's see, where do I want to go from there? I was going to start out with mayor, it's your fault. It's always the mayor's fault, right? What I enjoyed to see was when a year ago I was probably very critical of you of leadership on the council, and I think you'd heard me say it a couple times a year ago. And I appreciate the steps you've taken so far. The things that I had done wrong in the past with the council, where somebody has taken personal attacks to a certain levels, has disappointed me so much that I've spoke out sitting out there doing it. And that was the only time I've ever spoke out. And I firmly believe that we needed a gavel and on both sides, you know, people that were with you and against you. So having said that, you know, now I got to go home and watch TV and not have any events on my TV from city council because it's your fault. you've cut down the conversation to 3 minutes. I've talked to another council person that ran for council, and I'm sure you know his name. We both decided 3 minutes is more than enough to get your business done for those specific topics, and then 5 minutes to go and grandstand all you want at the end of the day if you can sit through the whole meeting. So I have to say is that my TV viewing and computer viewing has dropped off. I still watch you guys. I have to because it keeps me enlightened of what's going on with the council. There was one thing that I was disappointed that we need to do as a group. We are all neighbors. And hopefully there will be an apology coming down the road, because in public I think you need to all work as a team and stay on the same side of the fence. I don't think you need to go and treat each other like a pack of wolves, and well, wolves treat each other much better than what we've seen today. I honestly believe that you need to work as a team and call yourselves out after the council meeting. It would make me feel better as a citizen to see that, even if you guys disagree and if you don't think they're doing the job that they should be doing, do it outside the council. I would appreciate that. It seems like I'm picking on a person consistently, the streetlights. We're not shutting streetlights off. I'm surprised the police chief didn't jump out of his skin earlier that I had to add more lights. I live on a corner because the neighbors now can see my fence line and see last one was a drunk guy laying in my lawn. You know, so and it's out of the blue. It don't happen all the time, but I live on Henry Ruff, so it's a busy street. So more lights better than less. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Please only speak if you're at the podium.
Thank you, ma'am. Linda Bonovitz, 962 West Rose. I just wanted to say that I'm pleased that you voted in the 3-minute rule. When you come up to speak, you should speak on the subject you come up for. When you start to ramble, people tune you out. At home, I hit the mute button. I just wanted to mention, too, that I work for Garden City Public Schools. I'm a secretary and proud of it. I haven't had a raise since 2005. On top of that, we've given back. That's just the times that we live in, and that's what we have to do. I don't make threats. I vote in every election except for the special election for the former Thaddeus McCarter, whose name I never wanted to say again, for the money that he cost all of us, because I considered that a waste of my time, and I consider it a waste of time that our city hall had to take care of that. And I still have a right to my opinion, and I just want to say that I'm still very disappointed in the four of you that voted tonight for the removal of our city manager. I don't want a police chief to become our city manager again.
You can't speak on city manager, Ms. Bonovitz.
Okay, then I'm done.
Okay, thank you. That was on the agenda tonight, that's all. Items that are not on the agenda. Ms. Weissick?
I hope that sometime or other we can bring the city together and respect all our departments in this city. I know the chief gets lots of applause, but we have other departments that do good work too. And tonight I'd like to talk about our library and how great it's doing and looking. Friends of the library, they're all volunteers, took on the job of beautifying the outdoors, and they did it. It is beautiful. I hope you'll all drive by and see the work they've done. Our library has done so much with so little. Every city needs a library. And every city in Wayne County has at least one library, except Highland Park, and they're in very bad shape. And mayor and council should know what a great asset it is to have a library in our city. At least I hope you do. Because the consequences of not having a library are many. I hope you know the consequences too. And the assets are many. The building looks great. There's many more programs, new books. They can order you in a book they don't have. Seniors and children blending in, working together. There's no more bang for your buck that you get than from our library and what it offers this city. Now, me and my husband fought to keep the library when it closed, and everyone was mad at me. The men in the audience, the mayor, probably some council members. I think I've made peace with the men in the audience. Raymond and I are happy to be a small part of what we did to keep the library open. Mayor, I hope you still don't hold that against me. Every time you run into me, you would say, I'm not against the library. And I would say, you closed it. I still never convinced them. And I thought, that's like the bank saying, we're not against you, but we're going to evict you from your home. Now I will spend some time speaking about our DPW, the heroic deed they did with the police department. I live right next door to the Maplewood Center. And when they put all that siding on that building, you could not believe the superior work, because I had just had my house sided from the experts, and those men did so much better job than was done on my house. Then they put in all the windows. Those windows are so great. Two of the men had gotten their warning that they'll be laid off in 2 weeks. I was over there looking at the windows. They were working hard, still putting in those windows. Does anyone realize how much money they saved our city having the work done in-house? Tons of money. And what good workmanship is the main thing. Did they get any credit for their great work? Some were rewarded by losing their jobs. Did anyone cry for them? It was stated at the table, when we replace these men, we will hire new employees with much lower salaries and no benefits. Good luck with your new hires. You will probably hire a private company from another city to do the work, and any work you have to
That's
have
why
done.
I think you have 30 seconds.
Thank you. Which you are following right now. And what cost to our people hiring those outside companies? Don't be penny wise and dollar foolish.
Thank you. Anybody else? Mr. Weissick.
Some observations. I commend the actions in the best interest of the city taken this evening. I also have a question about Mrs. Lynch's remarks about she's aware of the many contracts or agreements that have been reached over a number of years without it coming before the council. I think it's obligatory for this council to look into that and to see if there were violations of the city charter for contracts being entered without approval by the council, and if council people were aware of it and did nothing about it. I think it's something you have to do. I also wish to concentrate the rest of my remarks on the mayor and his behavior. First, and tonight was good evidence of it, the disrespect and one-sided treatment he allows his buddies to do here at the meetings as to other council members and residents with different thoughts and ideas. Mayor, why have you not thrown out some of your buddies this evening even, or for other times where there was obvious and distasteful racial remarks and anti-constitutional remarks? Mr. Kerwin brought, or Mr. Fetter displayed a bill for a FOIA request for Mr. Kerwin, as he asked, which he rightfully had an opportunity to do as a council member, of some 700 and plus dollars. Now, I take it that was probably at a dollar a page. Somebody said 328 pages or something like that. Why does the city of Garden City charge a dollar a page for a FOIA request? Livonia charges 10 cents. 10 cents. Do we have gold here in Garden City? Is there some reason that it's 10 times more expensive for us to get a page ran through the Xerox machine than at Livonia? It's disgraceful. But it's also evidence that we don't want people to be asking questions in FOIA requests. And what's the best way? Charge the living daylights out of them. Last year I asked for some FOIA requests. I was told it was a dollar and a half a page. A dollar and a half a page. It was going to cost me $150. I passed. But they want you not to ask too many questions. Last mayor, meeting mayor, you complained how hard it is being mayor. Saying people who come to the podium don't realize that. Well, mayor, how many ice rinks have you built? How many closed schools did you turn in into community senior centers? Have you built any tennis courts, soccer fields, or other facilities? How many programs under your tenure have you opened? Oh, I forgot. We just keep closing them. Well, Mayor, if you either quit your whining about how hard your job is.
Yeah, 30 seconds, Mr. Weiss.
Or just step down. I'm going to finish by saying, what did you mean, Mayor, by what you said to me after the last meeting? I'm going to get your ass yet. I take that as a threat. I take that as a serious threat. And you made sure nobody else was within your sight. You threatened me at the last council meeting.
Your time is up, Mr. Weising. Mr. Goins?
Gomer Goins, I say again what I said there at the other meeting. This is a good night for Garden City, and there's a lot of happy people in town tonight. And I want to compliment these Pearson Porsons, and I'm really proud of you, especially Dave. And after listening to Dave, I wonder how many of them people that it has put the hushers on, and they'll quit jacking their jaws about what a good job that ex-city manager was doing. I had him pegged right off from my begin with, and I told you folks, I've seen him a dime a dozen. And I'd look over and see him sitting there squirming.
I don't think you can speak on the city manager. It was on the agenda.
Okay. I agree with you. And Mayor, I think it's time for you to call a council of the chiefs and have a powwow and smoke a peace pipe. Now, at that last meeting, I observed and saw Dave, extend to you the olive branch. Now, I don't know if this gap is spread too wide to where you can't get it back together, but I think it's worth a try, and I think you should grab onto that olive branch. And two, Mayor, I want to run something by you here, and I want your opinion on it. Now, so when I've been up here talking, there's some old gal sitting back there behind me, poking her tongue out at me and doing all kinds of gyrations, making faces and all that. I wondered if I could get your permission to bring a camera in here and get a picture of that and put it on the YouTube. Now, maybe she can get some suggestions what she can do with that tongue, and I have a good suggestion for her what she can do with that tongue if she wants to hear it, or I'll tell you. But now, and what I want to say to you, Mayor, is this. Now, you make the decision, and I know you want to run a good, calm, cool meeting, and if you want to put a stop to her doing that, or if you're going to condone her doing that, there will be response with like kind, and we don't expect to be thrown out. Now, I would like to say to some of you folks up there is I would suggest that you come ye up from among them and join the majority, because there's a fearsome foursome that's going to move on, and you're going to see this city move forward. After tonight, it's already been doing it some, but you're going to see this city moving big time. You're going to see some big changes. Now, I suggest you folks come here up among them, or sit up there and be a lame duck till next election.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Oh, ma'am, come on.
Hi, I just have some questions that you guys can think about for the lighting. Since we're going to have to start paying more, as we've been told, can we find out why exactly are we going to have to pay more? Was it because it was bad information given to us? Is it that some of the lights aren't being turned off like they were supposed to be turned off? Is the DDA not really paying enough of their share that's going to cost the rest of the residents? Also, do we know how many of the residents never paid that fee when it came out? And is that part of the increase, is that we're paying for what they didn't? Or is this just kind of a buffer to make sure that if things don't get paid in the future, you're going to have something, enough money to cover that? And another comment was something that you had said, Mayor, regarding that you didn't have any complaints from people. And I know this is not, I don't want to touch directly on the city manager, but in many cases, people choose not to say anything because of the repercussions of saying things. And people are just as much willing to sit back and let other people say things. I applaud these four people who stood up and voiced their opinion and said what was wrong. I was always brought up that you don't have to be like everybody else. And so therefore, I think that these four city council members did what they think was best, and I applaud them. And I think that more people within the city and anybody else who feels that something's wrong with their company, city government, whatever, stands up and voices their opinion no matter what other people think. And therefore, I'm really thankful that they did that.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Stephen Grant, 5841 Cardwell. Ms. Dodge, Mr. Cordy, Mr. Kerwin, and Mr. Fetter, you removed a roadblock to the future success of the city, and I commend you. We're having problems on Cardwell. I caught a mouse today. It's the first of the season. Last year I caught about 20. We need help. You guys touched on it a little bit. I'm hoping with what happened tonight we can actually get something done. Mayor, I don't know if that was directed toward me, but you know, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But I've been coming to, I'm new to the meetings, but I've lived next to this for nearly a decade. I've lived in my house 8 years. I've seen other houses in the neighborhood that got totally gone, and they've rebuilt them and they're living in them. And the house that lives next to me looks worse than ever. Now we have a half-done porch on a half-done house. I seen an old lady today almost fall in the yard. The grass it's long in the front. My wife called around today. I won't mention any names. Most of the people were nice. She got to one department and they were pretty rude to her and said that it wasn't their job and no comment. I'm not going to name names. We just want to get the grass cut. I mean, you know, it looks like an eyesore. I don't have a speech today, so I don't really know what I'm saying, but I guess that's all I'm trying to say. So just keep up the good work. Mr. Kerwin, Mr. Fetter, we appreciate it. Mr. Fetter, we really appreciate you looking into the matters. What I heard you say earlier, you found that document that I've been talking about that no one seemed to know about. I appreciate that. So thank you. And you know, I'm not a very political person, but I believe in you and Mr. Kerwin, and you know, I don't know the rest of you, so I can't comment. But just do us right. I mean, we've lived here a long time. A lot of people my age, you know, I'm not an old guy, I'm not a young guy. They don't want to live here, and we've been feeling that way. We've been feeling defeated. We just want to live in a nice neighborhood. I mean, my neighbors don't stand up. I don't know why. The people and comments I get about this property, I mean, I'm not here complaining. You guys never even seen me before until this issue. You know, I have no hatred toward none of you. We need help. You know, one day I want to sell my house, and it ain't going to sell with that thing next to it. That whole street is in a depression because of that property. So that's really all I got to say. So have a good night. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? Mr. Moeller?
I just wanted to say that the guys that robbed that bank, I know they sent the police department in Garden City something to thank them for not killing them. Anybody come out there with a gun in their hand, I mean, come on. That showed a lot of courage more than I would have. I would have shot him myself, but first time he shot, I don't care. Anyway, and the guy's house on Cardwell, he's right. That brickwork was done at least five weeks ago for that porch, and there's still no cement port for the porch. The guy's never going to finish the house. It's not the city manager's fault. It's probably the court's fault, because it takes so long for government to do anything. But that's 5 weeks ago, and I believe the man came up here and told everybody, once I get that brickwork up, you'll see how fast things go. The brickwork, the porch, the siding. Well, they got a form up on the porch for the cement, but it's been over 5 weeks, because I walk that area all the time anyway. And, I'll tell my wife, you owe me $1 when I get home. But that's all right, I'm going to make a deal with her. I'm going to get me a Yankee dime instead.
Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, city manager's report.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, you have received my city manager reports for the 16th and the 23rd. If you haven't received the 23rd, it's in your mailbox here, and yes, it was late. I was going to offer up an excuse, but Mr. Fetter has convinced me to stop wasting my excuses on it. They pretty well speak for themselves, and I, because this has been such a long and difficult night, I am actually going to move on to something else that arose out of a meeting that Ms. Bettis, Mr. Cordy, and I had recently, which was a discussion of the financial statements that you receive on a monthly basis. You have recently received the August report, and for the benefit of council and for the benefit of the public, I just want to touch on a couple of things. First, it's very important to keep in mind that this is a snapshot. It's important to keep in mind that certain expenses and certain revenues are cyclical, so that we might, for instance, find an area that is running way over budget currently, but the fact is, as it spreads out over the course of 12 months, it will come in close to budget. As of the August report, we had in revenues, we had achieved 37% of our projected revenues. We should be at 16 point something, we'll call it 17% now. So we are ahead on the projected revenues for the city. The first two-sided pages of this report give you a summary of that. On the revenue side of things, we are currently at 5%, and we should be at around 17%, but don't get too excited about that, because there are some major expenses that are at zero amounts right now, including debt service, I believe, Ms. Bettis, that's accurate?
Yes, sir.
Right. But you can use these as a guideline, look at the departments and see how they're doing. I currently do not see any department running at over budget at this point. And then if you do see a department that's running over budget, you can go further into the report and find out the details, which is what each of the department heads does when this report is received. They take a look at it, they see where they're going over, under, is it controllable? Is it cyclical and not something to worry about? Is it one of those vendors that for some reason bills us three times in the first 6 months of the year and which just throws the whole thing out of kilter. But I wanted to let you know where we stood presently. And we will continue to do this on a monthly basis with council and for the benefit of the public when this comes out. Mr. Cordy, it was an excellent idea that he brought up in our meeting as we were reviewing the financial statement, and we'll begin doing that now. I also want to make council aware of something, and I will probably only halfway explain it tonight because it came up at the very last minute, but DPS is working on a main break in the area of Sheridan and Harrison. The shutoff valve, in order to allow them to do that main break, repair that main break, is broken. So they have to move to the next shutoff valve. Mr. Barnes, please jump up and scream if I'm not properly explaining this. They have to move to the next shutoff valve that will, unfortunately, rather than shutting off just a small portion of the neighborhood, will shut off, about 20 or 25% of Garden City, including a lot of businesses. Fairly accurate?
We'd have to get into the meter pit and shut off the major distribution line, the 20-inch line right at the pit and then up a Ford Road.
Now, there's a solution to this, which involves an emergency contract. We've been working with Mr. Kern from Hennessy today to bring a contractor in that can perform a
line stop, again, like we used on a bigger scale for the 16-inch valves, where you put a line stop on either side of the valve, pull out the valve, put a new valve in. That way we won't be disturbing half of the cities as far as sediment and et cetera by opening the bigger valves. If we have to close the bigger valves, we'll probably disturb half the city with brown water. So we're looking at cost to do this line stopping and replace the valve. The company we're looking at is the company we did on the Maplewood project. We had to do one line stop over there. This is a 12-inch main over near the hospital, because the hospital didn't have dual feeds into it and keep from closing down the hospital. We had to do a line stop over there. So this company, the Hennessy engineers have had a lot of experience with this line stopping. And basically line stopping, you go on either side of the valve and put a temporary plug in it, pull out the valve, put a new one in, and then you can pull out the line stop and you can move forward.
Mr. Barnes, do we roughly know ballpark what it cost to?
I don't think we've gotten that far yet.
So we can give the city manager.
Unless Ryan has something later, because this is all developed.
Some direction
today
to make emergency repairs tonight while we're here.
Yeah, this just came up this afternoon. I will probably have a cost sometime tomorrow. I did try contacting the local contractor that does this work. Unfortunately, was not able to contact him this afternoon, left a message as well as sent him an email.
With a
CPI Excavating, they're out of Harrison Township. And we've had experience with them in River Rouge. Last year, they installed about 5 line stops there in their water main system, which is over 100 years old, and they can't shut down any of their valves.
You don't have a ballpark figure even?
I couldn't tell you. I wasn't involved with the costs and when we worked with River Rouge last year, but I will have probably an answer tomorrow, and they're usually pretty responsive.
What size line was it again?
It's a 20-inch line? 12-inch line.
12-inch line?
And our crews can't do this.
It's really specialty work. CPI is really the only contract that I know of locally that does this work.
There's not too many.
Right.
For Jack. Okay, right now we turned it off by the 20-inch main, right?
We haven't turned anything off. We have water running, right? It's right down just north of Sheridan on the west side of Harrison. The water is draining. It happened, we discovered it over the weekend. We tried to come in over the weekend to shut it down and do the repair. We couldn't, this valve was broken. We couldn't fix it, And then today we spent all morning trying to make sure the people on the weekend did their work properly, and we can't fix it. We can't fix it, about a 5-mile. And the only other way is to shut down the big 20-inch mains, and then that's gonna cause massive problems throughout town.
Okay, we can't leave a break out there for days and days. We need an answer like ASAP. right?
Well, I think we should, Mayor. And I was going to ask, once we find out what that cost would be and when they could be here, would it be advisable for the city manager to phone call us? I mean,
we can't take a vote on the phone.
Can't take a vote on the phone? That's why I want to know if we could prove up to a dollar amount. If we had a ballpark number, we could approve tonight up to a certain dollar amount for the city manager to make emergency repair.
Jack, do you remember what it cost us the last time on Maplewood?
That, what we did there is just, no.
And we add, put that in the contract.
That was, so that was probably less. When we did Maplewood, which has been three, 4 years ago. When we did the one there.
Because we can't just let a lot of things continue to run broken. That's one thing. So it has to be fixed as soon as possible.
Mayor?
But we want to make sure that we get the best cost and do it the right way.
I was going to say, I think that we have enough faith in Hennessy that they're going to get the best price out of it. They're going to work it hard. And if we possibly made a motion without a price and just giving approval for it to be done, because we don't want the 20-inch main shut off. That's for sure. That'll mess up a lot.
I don't know the price. I mean, explain that.
It'll take 24 hours to call a meeting, or 18 hours to call a meeting.
But also, we don't know if somebody's available either. So you're waiting till tomorrow, because there might not be somebody available till next week. And do we want a water main break to go on?
That's what this company does.
This company does respond to emergencies. So typically, in past experience, they're usually out within 24 to 48 hours.
We close a 20-inch, we're going to be affecting restaurants.
Yeah, we don't want to close that.
I would just leave it up to follow our emergency procedures, our emergency ordinance.
Let
Jack and Hennessy and the city manager do what's best. Mm-hmm. I mean, if they have to shut it down, they shut it down. If they don't have to, they call in, you know, this other firm to put in the blocks.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to give the city manager the authority, once he gets this dollar amount, to go ahead and go forward with the repair.
Right.
Well, I'm fine with him making the best decision for this water system. And that's how I would put it.
Jack, write him a check. We'll reimburse you next week, next meeting.
It's in the mail, Jack.
I'll have it right. I would ask one thing, Mayor, that the manager is authorized to do this. If somebody could check with, was it River Rouge?
Yeah, we did the work in River Rouge, yes.
Find out what their last quote was, if it's halfway similar, and or if it's that was what, Maplewood, 3-4 years ago, if it's within 15-20%. I just don't want to open the blanket. I mean,
we need them to do the line stop, and we need the valve.
You got to replace the whole valve.
We have experience. I've checked with McCruise. We have experience with 6- and 8-inch valves. 12-inch valves. It's big. It's bulky. You're going to have to break down the gate well there, basically cut out the valve probably.
Yes.
Get a new one in place with spacers and everything.
And we need it done yesterday.
And we need it. So it's going to be more expensive than the valve on Maplewood, because the valve was part of another project.
Right.
This one, we need to add the valve to this project. And then we're trying to find the cheapest way to get it done. If we have to, if this company can do the valve and the gates, the line stop, that's probably the cheapest way. If not, we'll probably go to our present contractor and maybe see if he's got the capability to do the valve if the line stops are done. So we're looking at both all the options to see the cheapest way to get this thing done in a timely fashion.
And fast.
Yeah.
And fast, because right now the mains, the water's running, but it's not totally affecting people, except we're wasting, you know, water's going down the drain.
Leave it up to the
we need to do it quickly before
we
have
a decision,
big problem.
And I don't want to give any specific where you have to go with this company, because if they choose that that's not the best route, I want to leave it to these guys to, you know, make
allow
the best
them to follow emergency
system.
Procedures and do what they have to do, knowing
I would agree.
They're going to do
emergency
the best.
Procedures. I would agree.
After they have it all done.
Ms. Bettis, do you happen to recall if there's an actual dollar amount?
Off the top of my head, I believe it's $5,000.
Okay. For the city manager?
Emergency.
I think it's $8,000.
I think we raised it, but I don't think the emergency was raised that much, but if it's 8,000, then okay.
The valve itself is probably $3,000 or $4,000, just buying material. That's not counting any spacers or anything there.
12-inch valve.
So we're probably talking.
I would guess it's probably going to be between $10,000 and $15,000.
Would it behoove us to put a cap at 15 and then just make a motion to repair it with a cap at 15? And then if it goes over, then we just have to adjust it accordingly. But at least you have the approval to get that done. You feel comfortable with that?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, somebody want to make a motion?
Mayor.
Oh. Ms. Lynch?
I move that we allow Hennessy Engineers and DPS to work to move forward with this emergency stop valve and replacement of the valve up to a cap of $15,000 and allow the city manager to oversee that process.
Support from Mr. Kerwin, discussion from council.
And just know that you're going to make the best decision. If it means that the best decision is to turn off the 20-inch, then that's what you do. You
whatever know, the best gonna, is.
I mean, if that's what
the best
has
decision.
To be done.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Any other discussion from
you
council?
No.
From the general public? Ms. Pettis?
Councilmember Lynch?
Aye.
Councilmember Kerwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Dodge?
Aye.
Councilmember Fetter?
Aye.
Councilmember Cordy?
Aye.
Councilmember Squires?
Aye.
Mayor Walker?
Aye.
And of course, council, I will report back to you as soon as, okay. as events you know. Unfold here. That's all I have tonight, Mr. Okay. Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Dodge?
Tim, did you ask Tim?
Oh,
okay. I've got one item, and I wish we had had a meeting last week. I think we, you know, probably could have. In fact, the mayor probably already did take care of this. But for Troop 1241, Nicholas Patrick Stalker, congratulations on becoming an Eagle Scout. We seem to have a lot of young men that become Eagle Scouts, and it's not an easy rank to attain, so congratulations. He was recognized at his Court of Honor this past Saturday, the 22nd, and I commend you, and that's all I have.
Thank you. Mr. Cordy?
Just one comment. I would like to thank Allison and Acting City Manager Bob Murray for meeting with me. I appreciate it very much. It was well worth it, and want to thank you publicly. That's all.
Okay.
I want to give a big thank you to a teacher at Farmington School. He knows who he is. I'm not going to say his name, but he had given a challenge to his classroom to do a random act of kindness over the weekend. Well, over the weekend, my husband and I drove by individually and saw this teacher outside at Farmington School with the edger by himself edging the badly needed school property all the way around, cleaned it up, made it look absolutely beautiful. And I just want to say, we noticed, I know other people noticed, they may not have stopped and said anything, but I want to thank you for, first of all, challenging the classroom for random acts of kindness, but for him to include himself and go that extra mile to take on a job such as that. Then I have one other thing, and this was for Mr. Wallace. I did review the tapes of that one meeting, and it was not my voice who was talking about Detroit and the 90-second rule. It was the voice of Mr. Walker. And so I just wanted to let him know I did go back and review. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Pettis?
Your Honor, I just wanted to let the public know that on Saturday, October 13th, from 8 to 2 p.m. at Southland Shopping Center on Eureka Road in Taylor, there'll be another household hazardous waste collection event. Bring your hazardous waste and electronic recycling. Any Wayne County resident will have house-generated things. It can't be from a company that's like
tearing down a house or something, but if you've got stuff that you need to have discarded properly, then that's an opportunity for you to do that. Do so. That's the last one this year. As everyone who has a television or a radio or billboard or a phone knows, we're having an election in November. The close of registration for that election is Tuesday, October 2nd. Tuesday, October 2nd. So if you're new to the community or if you're new to voting, you want to make sure that you are registered to vote by that time in order to be able to vote in the November election. Also, if anybody is here and has that particular need, I do have voter registration applications and we'll be happy to take yours. As you well know, and as I've said many times, I love it when people vote. That's an awesome thing for Americans to do. Also, if you are interested in an absentee ballot, I have applications for that as well here, and anyone who doesn't already have one planned can get those from me. If you don't happen to have that need tonight, please come to our office and we will get that information for you. The printer is still working on some of the ballots, although we do have most of the absentee ballots ready. There is going to be two sheets of paper, back and front, so there is a lot of voting to do. If you, like me, would like to be prepared for that and would like to find out, we expect within the next couple of weeks that we will have sample ballots. When we get those sample ballots, I also post those on the website so that you can either download them or come to our office and pick one up, so that you can review the things that you're being asked to vote on. Other than that, I think that's all for today. Thank you.
Mayor.
Oh, congratulations, Al, on your retirement.
Thank you.
Just a question for Ms. Bettis. I know the ballot issues are quite lengthy, and I know that to put the ballots front and back two pages is going to be quite lengthy as well. Is there any way that you could maybe start putting the ballot issues on the website so that people could read what exactly it says? Because there are some that if you listen to the commercials on TV, you really don't know why it's even there, what they're trying to skirt around or not. And if people had the opportunity to read them, maybe they'd be able to make a really informed decision.
And so that is what our intent is. We do think we'll be getting those sample ballots, which will have that information on it. However, I don't have the proof from the printer yet.
Okay.
So, and I don't want to do it without that. So, but we do expect to have that information very, very soon.
Okay.
And then, yes, of course, I will put that out there. Yes, ma'am.
Is that all? Is that set?
Go green.
Mr. Curran?
Yes, Mayor. To the gentleman who earlier said that I'm just sitting here trying to look smug, you know, I've had the same face and the same smugness, I guess, for a lot of years. I don't mean to offend anybody by that. I'm not sure exactly what he means. I think everybody up here is honestly trying to do the right thing. That's my opinion. There's not a lot of cronyism that goes on here by any means. A little more talk, maybe a good idea. And like I said earlier, I'm very proud that everybody here has come out, whether you agree with me or not. That's has nothing to do, but get involved, see what goes on, voice your opinion. There's not too many other things you can do in this country that are free, so you might as well take advantage. One more thing, I know people have talked before about what we pay Mr. Cronin, and then it was, they were trying to measure words or sentences, so if we're gonna pay him by the word, I don't think he'd be making minimum wage tonight, so. I thank you, Mr. Cronin. Other than that, that's all I have. Thank you.
Mr. Fetter?
Yeah, I have a few things. I want to take Mr. Chico's advice and apologize to Ms. Squares. I snapped at her, and I've apologized to her privately, but I said it publicly, so I want to extend my apology publicly. I hold no malice toward Ms. Squares. I'll just bounce it up to a big mouth in a heated moment. So, but I do apologize for my action to her. And some people did mention about talking to the Observer. I've never been contacted by the Observer for any of the articles. I got a call a day or two ago asking me to comment on the whole week of articles after they had all come out. And so I don't know why. Maybe they didn't want to call me. Maybe they don't care. But I'm willing to talk to anybody that asked me. Anybody could have, during this process, come up and asked me what I had. I would have told them, including the Observer. But other than that, I have nothing else. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Squires?
Okay, and I too would like to congratulate Nick Stalker. I was at the ceremony, and he's a fine young man and a great example of scouting. And to Mr. McCleary, I'm sorry things went the way they did tonight, but think of the glass is half full. No more verbal abuse from Garden City residents. And that's all I have.
Thank you. I too want to congratulate Nicholas Stalker on making the rank of Eagle Scout. Also want to congratulate DPS employee Al Sharpunas, who retires this Friday with 25 years of service with the DPS, and wish you all the best. Also, I got accolades from a resident for the DPS employees. Lady was out cutting her grass, resident, and the tree that's between the sidewalk and the street, which is on city property, had a huge hornet's nest, and it scared her. She went in and called DPS. They came out and removed it, and she was very, very happy, and she wanted to make sure that I said something about our DPS employees. So great job, DPS. A few residents brought up a few things tonight. I do go in several businesses every week in Garden City. I think they see me all the time. I'm all over Garden City. Yes, I wish we had money for other programs, tennis courts, ice rinks. I think everybody knows the issue in all southeastern Michigan is money for all municipalities. It'd be nice if we had a full pot of money where we could do all kinds of things for our youth and for our city, but as we all know, that's not the case. We'd have to come back and ask for some type of millage. I asked everybody at the beginning of the meeting for a nice, polite meeting. You must have missed it. Keith Bowers is a friend of mine. I tossed him out. I'm sure I'm going to hear about it. I'm sure he's going to call me. But he blurted out. I said, Mr. Bowers, you got to leave. So I try to be fair. And, you know, so I do, you know, I'm trying to be as fair as possible. Mr. McCleary, thank you for your service to Garden City, and I wish you the best in wherever life takes you. Okay? With that, no further business. This meeting's adjourned.